everybody, and welcome back to our Speed Studio atop of Victory Lane in Daytona. This is Speed Weeks on Speed, presented by LaVitra. I'm John Roberts, along with the whole Speed team, and we're just getting started with 70-plus hours of coverage from the World Center of Racing. For the next 90 minutes or so, we'll get you up to date on what's happening on the track and off and get you revved up for tomorrow's Budweiser Shootout. Let's go outside. The first session just ended moments ago, and we are taking a look at a picture. Actually, we're not taking a look at a picture outside right now. Now we are. I'm with you guys. We are inside the NEXTEL Cup garage area as the teams are starting to wind down this practice session and see exactly what their cars have as they prepare for the season starting All-Star Shootout, the Bud Shootout. And that practice is wrapping up, and they will have another practice session in a while. Now, Speed Channel loaded up a caravan of moving trucks and set up shop here at Daytona Beach. Now, all of our buddies are here to help cover Speed Weeks. Let's hear first from Ralph Shaheen.
Well, John, this is our newest invention that we brought with us this year to Speed Weeks 2004. This is our new Speed Channel stage. It's on the outside of Daytona International Speedway. It's right next door to Daytona USA. And this is going to be traveling to every NASCAR NEXTEL Cup event around the country. And you'll be able to see trackside live from this very stage, whether you're at Dover or Infineon or Phoenix or at Charlotte at Lowe's Motor Speedway. It doesn't matter. We'll be there with this stage, and you'll be able to see trackside and a whole bunch of other NASCAR programming on Speed Channel done right from this very stage. It's going to be very easy to find. I've been told there's going to be a blimp hovering over this stage with a light on it, which is very exciting. I like that idea. We're going to have all kinds of stuff. There'll be people handing out giveaways. There'll be new announcements made here. There's speakers. There's lights. It's going to be a really neat addition to our Speed Channel coverage of NASCAR NEXTEL Cup racing. Should be a great season for Speed Channel and the NASCAR NEXTEL Cup series together. Now, we've got an exciting day for you coming up here tonight on Speed Channel. Let me show you what's in store for you. Now, we're going to be on with you from 5 till 6:30 tonight, and we'll be covering everything that's taking place in the garage area. The cars are off the track now. At 6:30, they'll be moving on to the next Budweiser Shootout practice. Of course, Speed Channel will have that live for you. We'll have a different group of announcers covering that for you, but you'll see it live right here on Speed Channel, just as you would expect. And then at 7:30, well, we'll hand the microphones off again. Another group of announcers will come in, and we'll wrap up the day for you from 7:30 to 8 before we call it an afternoon here at the World Center of Racing. So it's going to be a very exciting night here on Speed Channel, right here from the biggest race of the season, the Daytona 500 and the Budweiser Shootout, as we get into this great Friday afternoon. So let's go back now down into the garage area and see what's happening down there as the cars have come off the track. Here's my colleague, Bob Dillner.
Ralph, a lot of activity here in the garage area. This car right here is Jimmy Johnson's 500 car, but the crew doing a lot of work on that Bud Shootout car. How are things going so far?
Things are decent. We're, the track's hot and slick right now, so it's not like what we'll see in the shootout. So we're just working through some basic things and waiting for the evening session tonight to really sort things out. But, you know, new tires, the first time for the Lowe's car in the draft. We had a problem in testing and crashed one of the cars, so we weren't able to draft then. So we're kind of using this practice session to work through some of that stuff that we didn't have a chance to work through in the test and have some fun, try to make some money on Saturday night.
I was going to say, it's got to be a little bit more exciting than testing when you were just going around one car at a time. Now you get in a draft.
Yeah, the draft definitely makes it a little better. Right now, though, you get maybe three or four cars out there, and it's teasing you. You're like, all right, you know, I've got some cars, but not enough energy or action out there to really have some fun. But it's going to be exciting. You know, there's a lot of good cars. It looks like everybody's quick. It's going to be a tough race in the shootout.
I know it was disappointing to wreck that car in testing, but what have you brought back down here with you?
Well, originally we thought we were going to bring back the shootout car. And once Chad went home and thought about it a little bit, we ended up bringing that car that we crashed back as our primary car for the 500. We felt that it was better, and the guys in the fab shop just busted their butts to get this thing turned around, get it to the wind tunnel, and get it back here. So we think we made it better than what we had before, so we'll just find out as soon as we start 500 practice.
And I know you want to step it up one more position in the final tally at the end of the year. Ready to go for that championship again this year?
Yeah, if we just, you know, do what we did last year, run strong, be there all year long, and don't burn ourselves out, I think the new point system will, you know, will be an advantage for us, you know, the way our season ended up last year. So if we can just do that again, you know, maybe we'll be the first NEXTEL Cup champions. But if not, we're going to put in 100%, have a great year with this Lowe's team, and have some fun.
16th fastest in this session. He's not smiling now, but I'm sure he will be by the time the green flag flies. John?
All right, Bob Dillner, thanks a lot. We'll get back to you in just a moment. But right now, let's look at the top speeds from this first practice session as the cars just got out on the track for the first time, and they're going to be trying to hash out exactly what's going on underneath the hood and underneath of the race car as they get ready for the all-star season-starting Budweiser shootout here at the Daytona International Speedway. Now, the speeds are in the draft. They are the cars that are out there going together. Kevin Harvick was the leader, and he was one of the guys that's going to be out there during the shootout without a teammate. It's very hard to be out there alone on a speedway like Daytona without a friend. Some other teams are going to be ganging up on Kevin Harvick. Of course, Kevin and the rest of the group will find out where they will start tonight, because that is decided not by qualifying, but by luck of the draw. Stick with us, folks. A lot more to come here on Speed Weeks on Speed, presented by LaVitra. We're going to break down the first practice session, also get you right up to the next one live on Speed.
Speed Weeks on Speed Channel is presented by new LaVitra. New choice. Here now. Ask your doctor today. And brought to you in part by NEXTEL Coast to Coast walkie-talkies in under a second. NASCAR and NEXTEL, partners in speed.
All right, well, there's a couple guys having some fun in the garage area. Boris said, Dale Earnhardt Jr., a couple guys that will be participating in tomorrow night's Bud Shootout. Welcome back, everyone, to Speed Weeks on Speed Channel, presented by LaVitra. This year, the Budweiser Shootout field is made up of the 2003 Bud Poll Award winners, along with past Shootout champions. Let's recap some of the action from the past 90 minutes. Now, you will remember that last season, Ryan Newman did not do well on the super speedways at all. Did a lot better later on in the season, but here, he got off to somewhat of a bad start to this season as he had a fender rub on the front tire there. No big deal. Alltel crew went to work and got him right back out on the track. Certainly not the way you want to start the first practice session. Got to keep a look at this week is Ken Schrader in the 49 car. They have picked up a full-time sponsor for the entire season in the Schwann's Food Company. Boris said, you saw him just a second ago messing around with Tony Stewart. Here he is on the track. Of course, he won the pole position at Sonoma in that 01 car, and therefore he earned his way in to the Budweiser shootout. Now, red flag comes out, and that's because Jeff Gordon had an oil trouble inside of his car. It was actually no big deal, a little too much oil in the container, and so he had to go back, and as the overflow went out on the track, they fixed that problem up. Let's take a look at the speeds here really quick. Kevin Harvick, a guy to keep an eye on, always does well on this racetrack. Sat on a pole here before, and he was the fastest in the Bud shootout practice. Right behind him, a rejuvenated Rusty Wallace, who just can't wait to get on the track this season. They're said third fastest in the 01. Elliott running the limited schedule. Mark Martin, Terry Labonte, Jeff Gordon, Blaney, Jamie McMurray, and Tony Stewart round out the speeds from the first practice. Well, it's time now to introduce yet another member of our Speed Channel broadcast team for Speed Weeks. He's an award-winning announcer, producer, and journalist, and he is Ken Squire, who played a major role in getting this whole thing put together, Ken, when I'm talking about the television thing. Now, the first major event to be shown flag to flag, Ken Squire made the call on that race. Let's take a listen to it.
Down to this. Out of turn two, Donnie Allison in first. Where will Cale make his move? He comes to the inside. Donnie Allison throws the block. Cale hits him. He slides. Donnie Allison slides. They hit again. They drive into the turn. They're hitting the wall. They're head on the wall. They slide down to the inside. Let's watch those third place cars. They're out of it. Here they come. Waltrip trying to slingshot. Petty is out in front at the line. Waltrip to the inside. Petty wins it. And there's a fight between Cale Yarborough and Donnie Allison. The tempers overflowing. They're angry. They know they have lost. And what a bitter defeat.
I had the window net down, but I still had the seat belts on, still had my helmet on. And he hit me in the face with his helmet, not his fist. He had his helmet in his hand. He hit me in the face with his helmet. And it stunned me. It surprised me. I didn't expect him to do anything like that. And I looked, and a couple of drops of blood hit down in my lap, and I said, I got to get out of this car and handle this right now or run from Cale the rest of my life. So I climbed out of the car quickly. With that, Cale went to beating on my fist with his nose.
All right. right, Ken. That is a great way to put that there. He was beaten on the fist with the nose. Of all the changes we have seen, the one thing that does not change is the emotion of that checkered flag at the Daytona 500.
I think it changed a lot of thinking in the United States. You know, that was the realization of a dream for many folks who believed in this sport so very much. And it was a great opportunity that we could demonstrate how much America cares and loves this sport. And they turned out in big numbers. The ratings were incredible from that first flag-to-flag coverage of an American stock car race. And thanks to the Allisons and Cale Yarborough, Richard Petty, all the heroes came through that day, and they gave us such a good race all day. Remember, it started in the rain. There was a lot of ifs about that event. A lot of people thought that CBS was way out of line trying to do that race. Well, they were certainly proved wrong. The naysayers found out that America truly does care, and they are committed to stock car racing as we see it in this NEXTEL Cup.
Well, Ken, along those same lines, something we just found out about it, the president, George W. Bush, will attend the Daytona 500 February 15th in Florida. It'll be his 19th trip to the state where his brother Jeb is governor. And George is planning on spending Saturday night with his brother and then attending the Daytona 500 on Sunday. Now, coming up on Speed Weeks on Speed Channel, presented by LaVitra, we're going to have much more from Ralph Shaheen and Bob Dillner in the NEXTEL Cup Garage as we see the group busily working on the All-Tail Dodge. First, I want to tell you about Fantasy Cup Racing. Manage your own team of NEXTEL Cup drivers. All right, there's the 20 car of Tony Stewart getting rolled into the garage for a little bit of work before he gets ready to go back out on the racetrack for the second Bud Shootout practice of the evening. Welcome back, everybody. NASCAR NEXTEL Cup driver Scott Wimmer is scheduled to appear in court on March 10th to answer to charges of driving under the influence. Last weekend, police in High Point, North Carolina, arrested Wimmer at his home after he wrecked a pickup truck owned by his employer, Bill Davis Racing. No other cars were involved, and Wimmer wasn't hurt. He plans to compete for Rookie of the Year in the number 22 Caterpillar Dodge and expressed remorse when we talked to him yesterday.
Lots changing in the sport, and you know, we're getting watched as much on the off season as we are during the regular season now. And I'm 28 years old, and I feel like I made my big major mistake in my life, and I'm going to learn from this. And I think Bill Davis and NASCAR and Caterpillar know that when I make a mistake, I only make a mistake once. And it's something that means a lot to me. A lot of people have called and supported me, and drivers and teammates and owners and everything. And you know, I'm excited to get back in the race car and get to racing and really learn from this experience and hopefully help a lot of other people learn from it too.
Wimmer's driver's license was revoked. NASCAR says it's going to wait until after Wimmer's hearing before deciding whether to take any action of its own. Well, time to head back to the garage area and a report from Ralph Shaheen. Ralph, what's going on down there?
Well, you know, when you talk about running the Budweiser Shootout, Bill Elliott, in a lot of ways, kind of owns this event. Let's see now, Bill. You've led the most laps here, over 1,100. You've led the most miles here, over 500. When you consider it's only a 70-lap race, that's pretty extensive. And you've got the fastest average speed of over 197 miles an hour in this event. Why are you so good in the Bud Shootout?
Well, that was kind of in the past. I think it's a little bit different today. I think these guys today are pretty good. You know, running around the cars, what we've run with in practice, you know, it seems like everybody's pretty good. It'll be an interesting race, a lot of fun.
What's the key to running the Budweiser Shootout fast?
Well, it used to be without restrictor plates, but here anymore is just having some good help behind you, because, you know, with the restrictor plate and the way these cars are arrowed up, you know, with the spoilers set up and things like that sort, you got to have help to make your moves and do what you need to do. You know, you got to have a good car, and then you got to have good help behind you.
Did you see any of that in this last practice session? You find anybody out there you think's going to help?
Well, right now, I don't know. I mean, I think we'll learn more tonight, because when you run now, you just run with a partial field. Like, I only ran with 10 or so cars at a time. It'll be a little bit different. Maybe once the next practice starts, everybody will go at the same time. Then you'll kind of know who to kind of jockey with and go from there.
This is a bit of a different season for you, because you know you're not going to be racing every weekend anymore. Have you approached this differently? Are you more relaxed, or are you more intense because you don't know you're going to have another weekend next week?
Well, I'm pretty relaxed. I mean, I'd never gone into a season not worrying about having to go to every event and having to be on every weekend. And I think from my standpoint, you know, after doing it as many years as I have, that's kind of a relief. I mean, you know, you get a little tired from the standpoint of doing it year in and year out, and I think you get a little bit of burnout syndrome. And that's where I was at. You know, as good and as bad as last season was, you know, it's kind of a nice relief to come into January, February, knowing you don't have to go to every single event.
Well, John, it is also good to know that Bill Elliott might be returning to that form that we were talking about. He was fourth fastest in that last practice session, and he'll be starting the Bud Shootout for a record 19th time.
All right, Ralph Shaheen and Bill Elliott, guys, thanks a lot. Of course, Bill wants to run up to 15 races this year. That is, if his owner, Ray Evernham, can find the right sponsorship. And we have a lot more to talk about as Nextel Cup drivers participating in the Budweiser Shootout get ready to continue testing. Right now, we're going to take a short break. You're watching Speed Weeks on Speed Channel, presented by LaVitra. Welcome back, everyone, to Speed Weeks on Speed, presented by LaVitra. We're back to take you right up to the next Bud Shootout practice session, which will be carried live on Speed right now. The ARCA cars are out practicing on the racetrack, but they are under caution. Let's go back to the garage where Bob Dillner is standing by with one of the newcomers to this All-Star Shootout. Bob?
That's right, John. You know, you heard Ralph Shaheen talk about Bill Elliott and his 19 years in the Bud Shootout. Well, for this guy right here, his first time ever, in fact, his first restrictor plate race. So that practice session, how was it?
I mean, it's indescribable. I mean, to go back and tell my BMW friends what's drafting like at Daytona in our Nextel Cup car, it's crazy. But I mean, it was a ride. I mean, the whole time, a little hair was standing up on my arms, and I was just laughing under the helmet. It was great. So, I really appreciate the opportunity the U.S. Army has given me. I mean, what our men and women are doing overseas. I mean, they're sacrificing a lot of lives over there so we can have this great country and be free and have racing. And hopefully I can get a good finish to give back to those men and women over there.
All right, you had the goosebumps, but let me see your hand. Was it shaking? No, you're looking pretty good right now.
It was shaking out there. I went up to Tony Stewart and Dale Jr. after, and I was like, this is crazy, man. This is how this is every week. And they go, yeah, with double the cars. But for my first time, I feel pretty good. You know, I didn't know what to expect going in. And, the biggest thing, I didn't want to suck at it. And we were out there, and Ryan gave me a great car, Jay Fry, Nelson Bowers, to give me this opportunity. I think I did pretty good my first practice session. Fenders are still on it. So Ernie's been, you know, coaching me on the radio, and Ernie Irvin gave me a lot of good advice. And got one more practice, and then that'll be the end of school for drafting at Daytona. I got to worry about tomorrow night.
Well, I think you passed. You definitely didn't suck because you were the third fastest out there. But we were just talking about the 24-hour race here held just about a week ago, and you said you were actually thinking about practice here in the Cup car during that race.
Yeah, I mean, driving around my BMW M3 for PTG Technology Group, you know, I was running the high line, the low line, just to kind of see what it's going to be like, you know, to get a vision of it, you know, for the Nextel Cup car this week. And unfortunately, we broke after 11 hours, but got some good practice last week in the rain.
Well, you keep that smile on your face.
Oh, yeah. Hey, maybe they should take the plates off and we should use the chicane in the back. That, I think, would be a good race.
Ah, then, John, this guy might have an advantage out here because I bet you he would beat everybody. What do you think?
I think so, Bob, and I know you'd like to see that. Well, the International Race of Champions Series, better known as IROC, begins its four-race season at Daytona 1 week from tonight, live on Speed. Since 1974, IROC has put drivers from different series in identically prepared cars to shoot it out on various tracks. Here's a lineup of invited drivers. The NASCAR participants are Ryan Newman, Kevin Harvick, Jimmy Johnson, Matt Kenseth, and defending IROC champ Kurt Busch, and Truck Series winner, title winner, Travis Quappel. Now, here are your open wheelers. Elio Castroneves is joined by Scott Sharp, Scott Dixon from the IRL IndyCar Series, Sprint Stars Steve Kinzer and Danny Lasoski, and USAC Triple Crown winner J.J. Yaley. Now, IROC is shaking down the identically prepared Pontiac Firebirds. Here's some action from earlier today. Now, Dave Marcus, Dick Trickle, and a couple other of the solder boys are helping to work the bugs out of the machines. You saw Scott Dixon right there getting ready to get out on the track in his car. They had a chance to see how these identically prepared race cars handle in the draft. And there's Jimmy Johnson, one of the guys who will be leading the NASCAR charge in the IROC series this year. All right, Texas, Richmond, and Atlanta will join Daytona on this year's schedule. Watch for live IROC coverage here on Speed starting next Friday at 5 o'clock Eastern. Well, Robbie Gordon is certainly one of America's most diverse race car drivers, whether he's behind the wheel of his NEXTEL Cup car for Richard Childress, competing in the Indy 500, or the Rolex 24 at Daytona, Gordon never lets a good race pass him by. But Robbie also has roots in off-road racing, and does that leave any time for hobbies? Well, listen to what he told our Speed News crew at Thursday's Media Day.
I just love to race, you know, outside of NASCAR racing. Obviously, I'm fortunate enough I get to do the Indy 500. We did 24 Hours Daytona, do the Baja 1000, and for 2004, I'm going to do whatever I, or 2005, do whatever I can to position myself into the Paris-Dakar Rally.
All right, there's a live shot of the track. Again, ARCA is under caution during their practice session. But, folks, if you are looking for more off-road thrills, stay with Speed Channel all season for World Rally action. Sebastian Loeb won last month's opener at Monte Carlo. See who gets the top spot on the podium at the Rally Sweden Sunday night at 9:30 Eastern, only on Speed. Well, here's another live look at the racetrack at the Daytona International Speedway. Right now, under caution for something that went on, and we're not too sure what it was in the ARCA series, but they brought out the yellow flag to clean up the track on the backstretch. And here in the NEXTEL Cup garage are the tire technicians going to work to see how this new softer tire is handling on the Super Speedway. Welcome back, everyone, to our continuing coverage of Speed Weeks on Speed Channel, presented by LaVitra. I'm John Roberts. We're here in our studio above Victory Lane at Daytona International Speedway. We'll bring you up to speed on what's happening. NASCAR NEXTEL Cup drivers participating in Saturday's Budweiser Shootout will practice once again at 6:30 Eastern live on Speed Channel. Let's join once again Ken Squire. And Ken, you see those guys hard at work on those tires right now. What exactly are they looking for when they're scraping stuff off the tire?
Oh, they're trying to find out just how much distance they're really going to get under real race conditions out here. Softer tire. They had a good hard tire. It ran for a while. These are a little stickier. They should get better traction. Again, that should escalate the speed a bit for our races down here at Daytona this year.
All right, well, let's take a look at some of how some of the other drivers fared in the first practice session. Go to a little bit of highlight action from the draft as you see Bill Elliott in the number 91. Talked to him just a minute ago. He told Bob Dillner he's excited to be out on this racetrack right now. Fourth quickest in practice. Looks like he's back to the Bill Elliott of old. Dale Jr. doing a little bump drafting.
Yeah, and Elliott, remember, this is the only time you'll see him at Daytona in Speed Weeks for this year.
All right, Mark Martin's crew is going to work on that car. That is a brand new race car. Are not track tested yet until today, so they're trying to work out some of the bugs on that one. Here's a look at some of the latest safety innovations in NASCAR. Elliott Sadler's number 38 machine has the roof escape hatch on it, Ken. He's one of the few drivers that has it because he's one of the bigger guys out there that needs to be able to get out of that car. And here's the guy everybody was looking at. Fastest today, Kevin Harvick in the number 29.
Who's ever going to forget those shots of Michael Waltrip when he came out of that sunroof last year and really introduced that gadget? Very important. I think that's one of the finest safety developments that NASCAR has put forth. Nothing like having to stay inside that thing if it's crushed.
And only Michael Waltrip could debut it quite that way. Now here's Ralph Shaheen with more live coverage from the Cup Garage. But first, we're going to take a look at speeds from the Bud Shootout practice times. Kevin Harvick on top, 188.458, and that was in the daytime. They're going to get a chance to run these again at night.
And take a look at Boris Said right there in third spot. You know, everybody sentimentally, I think, in that garage area would like to see him do well, as long as they finish just in front of him.
Gordon, Blaney, McMurray, and Tony Stewart rounding out the top 10 for the Bud Shootout practice from the first session this afternoon. Now it's Labonte, Schrader, Dale Earnhardt Jr. Remember, Schrader was also pretty fast in practice down here during preseason Thunder.
Indeed he was. And look at Newman way back. This is not indicative of what's going to happen tomorrow night here on Speed Channel. Watch for Ryan Newman in tonight's practice to move way up on the board.
All right, there you see the top 20 in speed. Let's go now to Ralph Shaheen, who is wandering the NEXTEL Cup garage area. Ralph, who have you found now?
Well, I found one of the drivers you mentioned in that list of top 10 names that are pretty quick in that first Bud Shootout practice. That's Dave Blaney over here. And Dave, maybe a bit of a surprise since this team was kind of just put together recently.
Well, they kept the core of the 23 team from last year, and they've kept working all winter. You know, Bill's kept them going without a sponsor, you know, on the hopes of getting one. So they've got, you know, they got good stuff, good cars, Felipe Lopez here, so it should run well.
How good was it?
It was average. We didn't feel like we were good enough. We didn't feel like we sucked up to other cars good enough. So they'll go to work on it over there and see if they can do something. It's, you know, tomorrow's race is no pressure. You might as well see if you can get the car better.
When we hear the drivers talking about the car doesn't suck up well, or it does suck up well, how do you test that? What are you trying to do? Where do you position yourself behind the guy in front of you?
Well, it's all just a positioning thing. It's, you know, you get a certain distance behind a guy, and you know, you kind of gauge how far the guy behind you is. If he's right on you, he should run you over that guy in front of you. And so after a while, you can kind of gauge how good you are and you know, how you stack up as far as pulling up the guys.
Are we talking 10 yards behind, 5 feet behind? Where do you know that, okay, I'm in that zone, it should be moving now?
Well, yeah, it could be 10 yards, it could be 40 yards. You know, at 10 yards, you need to get going and get up beside his rear bumper. So there's just a whole lot of things you try and just get a gauge on if where your car is good and where they need to work on it.
So what area of the car will the crew concentrate on now to improve that for you?
Usually they work in the front end, front springs, front shocks, to try and get the attitude right. That affects the cowl angle. They might even change the cowl to see if they can get the air into the carburetor better. So little things, and I can't feel any difference on the way the car handles, but now it sucks up. So it's hard for me to tell what they did to help it, but sometimes they find something out of the blue and it helps it.
Can you position yourself on either side of the guy or directly behind the guy to improve that sucking up ability?
No, I mean, you usually just test it directly behind a guy and try to get a guy lined up behind you. Yeah, the cars kind of act a certain way when you get side by side. You can help yourself there, but usually gauge it, you know, nose to tail.
The temperature has been dropping here last couple of minutes. Is that going to affect the practice session coming up?
I don't know. No, it'll just make the cars a little easier to get them handling good, be more of a gauge for tomorrow night. So I don't know. This is one that will count, though, for tomorrow night.
All right. Well, Dave Blaney and his sponsor, Whelan, will be together all the way through the Daytona 500, John. After that, big question mark on Dave's chest as to will there or will there not be a sponsor to keep this team racing through the entire NEXTEL Cup schedule.
All right, Ralph and Dave Blaney, guys, thanks a lot. Cars on the track right now are from the ARCA series as they're winding down their practice session, and we are just under an hour away from the second NEXTEL Cup practice session for the cars participating in the Budweiser Shootout. Now, it's no surprise that aerodynamic changes are on the minds of race teams in Daytona. Fox and Speed Channel analyst Jeff Hammond tells us the Ford teams seem to be making the most out of NASCAR's 04 alterations.
In a year of politicking, believe it or not, the first big winner is Ford. During the off-season, NASCAR and Ford had several discussions, and NASCAR allowed Ford to come up with a new design on their nose. Not a lot of the change, but big enough should be a big benefit for a lot of these teams. And the reason why, this new front nose should make more downforce. Again, it should make the car drive better for the driver. Also, as far as the engines are concerned and drag, it should be able to run a little bit more tape. Car still be cool enough so it doesn't overheat the engine. By doing that, less drag, again, more downforce. Should be a big plus for a lot of these drivers that drive these blue oval cars. Now, we talked about engines a second ago. Hey, another big change was right here in this area, the cylinder head. What NASCAR did there, they do a lot of testing during the course of the season. As the race ends, they'll take the different guys, the way they finish, whether it's a Chevrolet, Dodge, or Ford, put them on a chassis dyno. During that period of time, they measure the horsepower at the wheels. They felt like that Ford was at a disadvantage. Again, NASCAR went to Ford, Ford went to NASCAR, however you want to look at it. A lot of politicking went on. A newly redesigned cylinder head. Now, that should, again, make more horsepower, more torque. Drivers ought to love it. Should make a lot of these guys a lot happier than they were last year. Now, we all talk about making somebody happy. Matt Kenseth may have won the Drivers' Championship, but he only won one race. Ford didn't lead a lot of laps. That's one of the biggest reasons why you see this change here. Now, to complete the package from the front, we got to look at what happened here at the back. Check this here out. Newly designed rear tailpiece. Now, this rear end of this car now looks a lot like its counterparts as far as the Chevrolet Monte Carlo, as well as the Dodge. Reason for this, again, NASCAR felt like this car was not as balanced as the Dodge or Chevrolet. So Ford went to work, came up with another new tailpiece, made these cars a lot more have a lot more downforce as well as not as much drag. This should be a big plus for these guys when it comes time to go racing, because when you go into the yaw, this sharp corner here, longer bottom piece here, makes the car a lot more stable. Again, you're looking for balance, stability, as well as you want the car as fast as possible as far as reducing drag. I believe this new tailpiece will be a big plus again for the 2004 Ford. So look for these guys to be really a lot better than what they were in 2003.
All right, Jeff, thanks a lot. Joining us now to talk about Ford's new aero package is former NASCAR crew chief Robin Pemberton, who is now field manager for Ford Racing. And Robin, if anybody really needed the changes right now, the Fords were behind the times when it came to the nose and the tail.
Yeah, they were. I mean, we, basically the car, the Taurus today that we have, was the baseline for all the new aero matching cars, you know, the roof and the rest of that thing. So all the Chevrolets and the Pontiacs that used to be here and the Dodges, they came from the Ford originally, the Taurus. So, we've been a couple years stuck with this little design here, and the Taurus has got a new 04 model coming out, and, we took the opportunity to put some of those new features into our Winston Cup car.
Now, we saw during the preseason Thunder test session that the Ford teams were really taking advantage of it. It looked like their speeds were up and they were performing really well. Is that directly associated with the changes?
Yeah, definitely. We knew we needed to get some drag off the cars, and like I said, we need a new tailpiece, and that was probably the biggest thing that's helped. And with the nose and, subtle changes there have helped the front downforce. And we had to juggle this whole thing as we were developing it, because you wanted to take the opportunity to help the cars for the downforce tracks also.
Well, Jarrett gave you the last two Ford victories here, right?
And was that in this been millennium?
Yeah. Well, you're starting over?
Yeah.
So, but now, forget all the bluster and so forth that goes with the week before the 500. Real shot at it this year?
I think so. I mean, I really do. With putting the new engine package, the new cylinder heads that are coming out, and we probably won't run those for half a dozen races yet. There's some further development to do on them. But with the new engine group coming together, with consolidation between the Yates and the Roush group, I think that's going to be a feather in everybody's cap. That's going to help.
Talk about that.
Man, there's just so much that went on, all the engines for our Winston Cup cars will come out of one stable now, and with the work from Jack Roush and his group and Robert and Doug Yates, I think it's a win-win for everybody.
Now, when it comes to aerodynamics, you find out where you're sitting when you come to a track like Daytona, don't you? That's when you really know.
Yeah, and the guys like it. Not all guys like it. I mean, I know Fatback hates it to death, but this is a time when it's all mechanical, mostly mechanical and aero, and it's what the guys do in the shop to make the cars the best. And the driver has very little to do with it, so it's basically the machine, and it lets you know where you stand in a hurry here.
All right, Robin Pemberton, thank you so much for coming by.
Thanks,
good luck with all the Ford teams this year.
Good to see you. Good to see you again.
Well, it's time for us to take a short break here at Daytona. And here's a quick look at Saturday's lineup, part of our more than 70 hours of coverage on Speed Channel. NASCAR NEXTEL Cup practice is at 10 a.m., followed by our Speed Week studio show at 12:30. You'll see more Cup practice at 1:30, and it's time to go racing. Speed will have live flag-to-flag coverage of the ARCA 200, then Speed News will serve you as the pre-race show to the Bud Shootout. All right, here's a live look at some of the busiest guys at the track during Daytona Speed Weeks. The NASCAR officials, they have many new rules to enforce and lots of new changes to put in effect. Welcome back, everybody. Getting called to the big red hauler after a race is NASCAR's equivalent to getting sent to the principal's office after school. But with NEXTEL as the title sponsor of the series, the trailer has changed color. As Speed's Bob Dillner found out during preseason Thunder, all these changes have caused a little bit of confusion.
It's all a brand new day. NEXTEL signs are everywhere up here, and the Winston banners look like they've been taken down, and so it's all brand new, which means that, hey, a guy like me, we're all rookies then, aren't we?
So you're gonna make less mistakes than they do, because a lot of these guys are still staying to win the Cups here.
I'm gonna try to make sure that whole NASCAR NEXTEL Cup thing, the two ends kind of get a little bobbled there, but we're gonna work on the NEXTEL Cup thing, make sure we get it right.
How many times have you messed up though and called it the Winston Cup Series while you're down here?
Well, I haven't said it yet, so I don't mess up till I get used to it. I said this other night, I think you take this, the whole Winston Cup, not Winston Cup, NEXTEL series, right? Better get that straight.
If you do screw up, mm-hmm. How about giving me $1 every time you screw up?
All right, and every time I don't, you give me one.
What's that patch right there?
That's last year's suit. Still looks good, though, but I've got newcomers coming on the block, so that'll be here next time I'm down here.
It's hard not to say Winston Cup, but it's even harder to say NEXTEL. It just doesn't sound right.
So hopefully after a few times of saying it, it'll just become natural.
Well, I just had a problem a little while ago because I was having to say net zero high speed Chevrolet and then Nextel Cup Vision, and I had to do a couple of retakes on that one.
But there is one other problem. You see, in the past, when a driver got in trouble, they were always called to the big red truck by NASCAR. But as you can see, it's no longer red. So the question is, what do you call it?
I don't know, but I'll probably get lost because I'll be looking for a red truck. But I don't know. It's pretty ugly still. So when you get called to it, it's not going to matter. It's still going to look the same inside. It's going to be pretty intimidating inside.
Amongst our internal guys, the phone booth is taking on a lot of popularity.
Is the phone booth as intimidating as the big red truck, though?
Well, if you think about Superman jumping out of the phone booth when I was growing up in the comic strips, it's not a bad idea.
The phone booth? Oh, that wasn't funny. That wasn't funny at all.
You know, the phone booth just doesn't quite cut it. So who better to ask what to name this truck behind us than our resident expert, Jeff Hammond. So, Jeff, what do you think? It used to be the big red truck. What do we call it now?
Well, Bob, I've been thinking about it. When I look at it, it reminds me of the white elephant. Remember, it never forgets. That's NASCAR all summed up.
Let's find out what the guys think about Jeff's idea for the white elephant.
I think Hammond needs to work on it. But that's Hammond. You know, what can you say? Jeff's smoking crack. I don't know what Jeff's thinking there.
All right, Bob, perhaps that was a little harsh. We got to give you guys the benefit of the doubt. That story was shot back during testing, so the guys that were still having trouble with it, I think, Bob, they got it down by now. You're here with us, though, to take a tour of that trailer without a name.
That's right. Well, actually, it's got a couple of names, depending on who you ask. In fact, the latest one I hear is the White House, but Barry Collins has been nice enough to let us in this trailer. One pet peeve of mine, though, NASCAR's got to do something because it's height discrimination here. I'm 6'5", and I don't quite fit in here. Guys like Jeff Gordon, Mark Martin, they slide right through. But here's what's cool. We get to come in this trailer and check this out. Some of the confiscated parts from the first day of practice here at testing. This off of Jimmy Spencer's car, some interior tin work. And check this out from Kurt Busch's car, the number 97. Some tubular bars right here, and those were confiscated out of the room of doom today. But so many other things happen in this truck, and the most important thing, they got to keep these guys fit. You see the officials, you know, they're definitely well-fed. You got mints here. You got Oreo cookies. You got a little snacks. John, you would like this trailer a lot. I don't know about Ken Squire, but maybe Ken would like a little fruit. But they have the snacks. They have the good stuff, the bad stuff, a bunch of lockers here. But the most intimidating thing about the big white elephant, as Jeff Hammond called it, is this room up here. And we're going to go up into where not many people get to go. And it's pretty neat. This is where they bring the drivers. In fact, Jeff Gordon is over here right now. And, you know, I've been called up into this trailer once before, and it's not a good thing. John Darby, the series director, and Jeff Gordon up here. Jeff, what's the matter?
Nothing.
What are you doing up here when you're not called to come up here?
How do you know I wasn't called up here?
So why are you in trouble?
No, we're in good shape.
So what name do you like? I've heard the White House, the phone booth, and the big white elephant, as Jeff Hammond called it. What do you like?
I like the phone booth. That sounds good.
But the phone booth isn't intimidating, though.
So the big red truck was intimidating. I don't know. We have to think about that. Give us a little while.
John, I got to thank you for letting us up here. But I've been called up here once before by Mike Hilton, but I've never been yelled at by you.
Well, you're fortunate.
Give it time.
Yeah. There's always time for improvement, and I think I got you on my list somewhere. Dill Weed, Dill Pickle, Dill, what is it? Dillner, and the intimidation part. I used to watch cartoons, and when Superman come busting out of that phone booth, he always scared the hell out of me.
That's true. But yeah, I feel like I'm back in high school here being called Dill Pickle. But I like the white elephant. That's what Hammond wanted. How about it? Let's just call it the white elephant. What do you think?
Too much like a clothing sale, I think. I'm going to go with my buddy Jeff here. Phone booth's the one.
Yeah. All right, there you go. The NEXTEL phone booth. John, you got Jeff Gordon up here, John Darby, and I'm out of here because I don't want to spend any more time because the big guy behind me will start yelling at me.
All right, Bob, thanks a lot. And I think all of us here, we like the phone booth too. I mean, the white elephant had, it was somewhat catchy, but we're voting for the phone booth, and we always listen to what Jeff Gordon says.
Exactly.
All right, Bob Dillner, thanks a lot. Folks, for the best weekly motorsports coverage, watch Speed News every Saturday and Sunday night at 7 o'clock. Tomorrow's show will be an expanded one-hour edition so we can bring you live reports from Daytona. Stick around. We'll be right back. Well, welcome back, everybody. This is Speed Weeks on Speed, presented by LaVitra, and the sun is beginning to go down over the Daytona International Speedway, and what would a trip to Daytona be without a sighting of the king himself, Richard Petty, responsible for so much great history at this racetrack. Richard, always a presence in this garage area. Well, it's time now to take a look at some of the other series competing at Daytona this weekend. The ARCA RE/MAX Series has its biggest event of the season Saturday afternoon at 4, live on Speed, and they just wrapped up their practice session. Just a moment, the track is quiet right now. Now, this afternoon, we learned Deborah Renshaw has stepped out of her ride and will be replaced by Chad Blunt. ARCA drivers qualified for their 200-miler Thursday. Let's take a look back at some of the qualifying highlights. Ken, five-time champion Frank Kimmel out on the track, qualified fourth. He's always a force.
He will be indeed, but the guy up on the point is the guy that is going to be real troublesome for the entire field, no question about it.
All right, you saw there in the Chasers car, Brandon Knepp failed to qualify, and there we see young Kyle Busch doing the ABC schedule this year out of the Hendrick Motorsports stall. You better keep an eye on this young man.
Indeed, ARCA and Busch get a little chance at a cup race this year, the ABCs.
Bill Venturini finished in the top 10 in points last season, but his qualifying run was disallowed because of some illegal fenders. He goes back to provisional land, and there we see Ryan Hemphill, 35th. Ryan Hemphill in the 77 car, as we see him get ready to pull off out onto the racetrack. Now let's take a look at the starting grid. Bobby Gearhart's won here before, won a pole last year for the second year in a row. He will start first, joined on the front row by Kyle Busch.
And looking a little further back in the field, Greg Sachs out of Matatuck, New York, is re-entering here. He's going to be in this ARCA race, and Sachs is going to be coming out of the ninth row in 17th position.
Shane Meal back behind the wheel of a race car this week. He will be starting in the 11th position. Andy Hillenburg in the 10 car back in the 28th spot. Jim Walker and rounding out the top 30 of the starters right there. Let's go on back in the field. There's Billy Venturini back in provisional land after that mishap with the fenders, and Todd Boucher is your last guy to get in on the qualifying grid. Now the Advanced Auto Parts 200 is scheduled to air Saturday at 4 o'clock Eastern time. Bob Dillner will have the play-by-play for you, and that again is live on Speed for the season opening for this ARCA series. Now, Ken, you've seen this series over the year grow. Some of the best drivers we've seen have come from that series. What does the field look like this year?
It's an interesting field because it looks a little different than it's ever looked before. You know, they're taking a page out of the monster trucks, Bigfoot and the Grave Digger and the Carolina Crusher, and where the numbers usually are on the side, there's still numbers on the roof, they've got names. Names are being demonstrated. The Force, well, that's one name, but there's also the Turtle, and there's Homer. They haven't quite got it all together in this department yet, but they're putting names on the dash trucks. Now, this is no longer a NASCAR series. It's an independent series, and they're fighting for their life, and they wanted to come down here. Speedway allowed them out for this race, and it's a good start, and they've got a big field of cars.
Now, Ken, of course, we're speaking of the dash series, known for so many years as the Goodies Dash Series. That sponsorship went away, so did the NASCAR sanctioning, and they also have a very unique qualifying system for these cars.
Well, it looks like Formula One. Well, that's not quite right, but they have several cars
fenders,
out there
right?
at once with fenders, right, and just as much heart and just as much soul, and they timed them with several cars on the track at a time.
Interesting thing to see out there.
Yeah, a little different.
And it's an interesting series because, again, some other drivers spawned from the series.
Well, it has spawned them, and there was a big question as to why NASCAR elected to drop them. It was a great short track series, but it didn't have the snap. It didn't have that spark that you get out of the Busch North series, naturally the Big Busch series, which has turned out to be the number two series in American racing.
All right, let's take a look at the qualifying results. Eric Wilson will be on the pole. He'll be joined on the front row by Danny Bagwell. On through the field we go. It's York, Brewer, Weaver, Humphrey Day, Bruce Hobgood, and David Heitzhaus rounds out the top 10 in qualifiers. You see their speeds on top up there, 166 miles an hour, just a hair over that for the pole speed.
Yeah, they're not the quickest things in the world. We're talking about four bangers here. Remember, this is the series that first brought us Toyota. Forget about Tundra. Yeah, it started right here in this division.
All right, Ken, Speed Channel will also show this one live starting at 3 o'clock Eastern time, immediately following Bud Polk qualifying for the Daytona 500. Here's one more ARCA Series car out on the track right now. There again is the Goodies Dash Series time, Sunday live at 3, and we'll be back in just a moment. Well, just a reminder for you folks, NASCAR NEXTEL Cup Series practice for the Budweiser Shootout is coming up at 6:30 live on Speed. See drivers and their teams get their cars dialed in for the big dash for cash. Here's a list of the drivers who are eligible for the Shootout. Everyone on this page won at least one Bud Pole Award in 2003. Of course, Ryan Newman led everybody with 11. Now, here are more pole winners from last season. See some of the best drivers in the business right there, as well as a newcomer. Boris Sett is up there as well, Stuart Harvick and Skinner. And these guys are in because they are past winners of this event. Earnhardt Jr., Mark Martin, Rusty Wallace, Schrader, Bill Elliott, and Dale Jarrett. All right, folks, let's go back down now to our colleague Ralph Shaheen, who is now back outside of the track at the speed truck.
Well, John, this number 8 here is obviously the future number of Dale Earnhardt Incorporated, but these two gentlemen have the reins of Dale Earnhardt Incorporated from the driver's side and from the management side. And let's start with the driver's side first, Dale Earnhardt Jr. You had a little trouble in that first practice session for the Bud Shootout. How's your car?
Well, we weren't really good there. We ran 4 or 5 laps pretty good there at the start of it, and then we came in and made some changes on the car. I think we loaded the sway bar up, and it didn't turn too good ever since. But Junior will get it figured out, and I was kidding with him, told him I thought he might have dropped a corn dog stick down in the carburetor or something while he's working on it, but he'll get it figured out, and we'll be hammering on him on Sunday there.
So just a pretty simple high-tech fix, that's all it's going to take, huh?
Yeah, I think just got to reevaluate the whole thing. He's been over there working on the 500 car trying to get through tech. He ain't even turned a bolt on that car all day long, and we got to jump in and go, and it just wasn't set up just right, I guess, so we'll get it figured out.
All right, well, don't go anywhere just yet, because I want to introduce everybody who might not have met you before, Richie Gilmore, even though you've been around this sport for so many years. A lot of people don't know you because you've been in the engine room, but now your name is on the management side of Dale Earnhardt Incorporated as you take over motorsports operations for DEI. That's a big name to deal with. Are you prepared for this?
Yeah, I am. You know, the big thing I've learned being around this sports a long time is people. People is what makes it, and we've got a lot of really good people.
Now, you're going to be dealing, I understand, mostly with the nuts and bolts still of the operation. There will be a separate division that will be handling marketing and sponsorships and that sort of thing. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct. We're putting a new deal together to handle the sponsor service side of it, and we're going to kind of separate that a little bit from motorsports and just kind of let us focus on the nuts and bolts side of it.
Now, I know you've had an opportunity to watch Junior grow up over here, but now you get to work closely with Richie. And is this a great move for Dale Earnhardt Incorporated at the right time to have a director of motorsports operations now?
Yeah, I think so. I think anybody in this garage would love to have Richie in the position that he's in for them. I feel like I've known him, you know, since I was a little kid, so I feel like I got a great relationship with him. And he definitely is a racer, and he's going to make sure I got the best cars, and that's all that really matters to me is that I get in a fast car on Sunday. Everything else should fall into place.
Now that you've seen this move take place, does this make you feel like Dale Earnhardt Incorporated is as strong for the management side as it's ever been?
We're heading in that direction. There's a few more pieces of the puzzle. I think everybody agree at Dale Earnhardt Incorporated. There's a few more voids we got to fill, and we're on track to make everything the way we want it, and I think, you know, the changes we made were definitely for progression. We didn't take too many steps back, and things happen and things, people come and go in this sport, and that's something I learned at an early age, and everybody's not going to be around forever, and as long as I really enjoyed working for Ty and working with Ty, things change sometimes, and he'll be an asset to somebody wherever he goes, and plugging Richie in was the best thing that we've done for the company over the off season, and I think he's really going to make a big difference for us.
I know from the driver's side you feel like you've got the talent ready to go, and I'm sure you feel like you have the equipment ready to go to run for this championship. Do you feel now that with Richie in his position you've got the support behind you to make a good solid run at it this year?
Yeah, well, that's one of the key things about Richie being in the position he's in. is that he's a racer, you know, and he knows what it takes to he knows what you have to have and what you got to build on to make fast race cars. Not only just building motors, building race cars. People, he's a good people person. He's great within. He's great hiring within. You know, and so when somebody comes to work at Dillon Oil Incorporated, they're going to get what they expect and what they're promised through Richie, because he's a straight shooter. And so I feel pretty confident. You know, he's gonna attract a lot of people to the company, and he's going to make it a better place for us.
And John, I think the biggest thing of all, when they get Richie Gilmore working in there with Junior and Tony Urie Jr., then instead of just corn dog sticks, pretty soon they'll be carbon fiber corn dog sticks.
All right, Ralph, Dale Jr., and Richie, thanks a lot, guys, and we look forward to seeing that high-tech technology being put in on the racetrack. Now, earlier we showed you highlights from the 1979 Daytona 500. We're going to continue our look at more historic moments by noting the 20th anniversary of the 1984 Great American Race.
See the green flag flying. They are away. The 1984 Daytona 500 is underway. Here comes Yarborough by the Silver Fox, chasing the two-time champion, Darrell Waltrip. And Yarborough hitchhiking on the rear bumper.
Well, of course, at this stage, you've got to ask yourself whether, in fact, he wants to leave now before the last lap, having seen the leader in the last two major races, he'll lose out on the last lap.
And they're all back together as they come out of turn four. Seven drivers vying to win the Daytona 500. Yarborough edges to the outside. Back straightaway, final time. Down to the inside. The move he loves. Here he comes up to the inside. It is Cale Yarborough taking first as they get into turn number three, coming for four. Down to the inside. Here comes Earnhardt.
Cale Earnhardt.
Earnhardt trying for second. Bonnet trying to find a place to run. They're coming to the finish line. At the line, it is Cale Yarborough.
I'll tell you, this Hardy Chevrolet just did a fantastic job. Waddell just had the car working so good. We never had any problems whatsoever. And, you know, all I could do was drive it and just went to the front.
I'm John Robertson. Welcome to another half hour of Speed Weeks on Speed Channel, presented by LaVitra. A live look at the NEXTEL Cup garage area shows you that the sun is beginning to set over the International Center of Racing at Daytona. The teams are getting ready to go back out. Here we see some ARCA teams working on their car as they are still on the track. Every once in a while we hear one of those ARCA cars go out, but they're going out very sporadically right now as most of them are back in the garage right now working on the cars. Let's continue our coverage by throwing it down to Bob Dillner. Bob, take it away.
Well, John, the ARCA garage has one of the more interesting stories so far of Speed Weeks, and it's kind of like a soap opera, so bear with me here. You see, Deborah Renshaw qualified this number 64 car, but she wasn't too fast. Her teammate, on the other hand, Ryan Hemphill, was very quick. Well, Deborah wasn't too happy with that, so she went to car owner Todd Braun and said, hey, I want what's in the 77 car. And he said, you know what, Deborah, just drive the car, we'll get it better. She said, absolutely not. She climbed out of the car. She's not in the ride anymore. And you know, the funny thing is, the person who is climbing in the ride is this guy right here, and he happens to be Deborah's boyfriend, Chad Blunt. Now you're in the car. You were sixth quick. She was like 30th quick. So are you still dating?
I think so. I mean, they're still here. We just, we did some changes to the car, really. I mean, when you get in a draft, she never had the opportunity to get in a fast draft, and we did today. So, I mean, that's what it means. I mean, it don't matter. I mean, if she'd have been in or me, I really don't know what to say. I mean, it would have been all right, but it's all about the cars around you, and if she would have gotten the same pack as we did, she would have went just as fast, maybe even faster.
Valentine's Day is coming up. Is it going to be a sweet one, or is it going to be kind of a cold one?
No comment.
Pretty interesting. The team down here kind of mum about what's going on here, and it's pretty interesting. Like I said, it's like a soap opera, and I'm sure Kenny Schroeder and I will be talking about that in the booth tomorrow, live on Speed Channel, the ARCA race. And I think, Ralph, you're standing by with him right now, aren't you?
Well, that is who I'm standing with, your broadcast colleague and Budweiser Shootout driver, Kenny Schroeder. So you're going to be doing some ARCA races with Bob Dillner this season, I hear.
Yeah, we're doing, I think, all the companion races. Got to do some with him last year and really enjoyed it. So he's one of those smart, really smart guys, knows what he's talking about. So it was a lot of fun to do it with him.
Okay, so that means you're taking the offensive and firing the first shot. All right, well, we'll hear from Dillner, I'm sure, a little bit later on.
Serious. I really enjoyed working with him. He was pumped up, really enjoyed the races. It was neat working with him.
Yeah, right. Well, we know how you are, though, Schroeder. The more you say things straight like that, the more I know you're lying.
I kind of messed up there. Actually, I like him because he reminds me of working with Mikey Waltrip. He makes me feel smarter.
Okay, now there's a real Kenny Schroeder. All right, let's talk about your race car here. How's this thing going? You got a new sponsor, and you were 12th quickest in the Bud Shootout practice. Does that mean anything?
Not really. The last time I looked, Dale Jr. was behind us, and, you know, he'll probably be pretty good. There's no reason to think he won't be. But the car was driving real good. The 500 car is good. It was in testing. We brought the other car down for the Shootout and felt good day. We'll go out and run this last hour, tweak on it a little bit, and be ready for tomorrow.
All right, Kenny Schroeder ready to go racing with his new sponsor, Swans, on the side. He's all fit, lean, mean, ready to go, and already picking on Bob Dillner. John?
All right, Ralph and Kenny, thanks a lot, guys. Saturday will be another important day of practice for NASCAR Nextel Cup drivers. If they're on the track, Speed Channel will show them. Join us tomorrow morning at 10 Eastern for more Speed Week's coverage presented by LaVitra. Welcome back, everyone, to Speed Weeks on Speed, presented by LaVitra. A beautiful sunset over the Daytona International Speedway as the NASCAR Nextel Cup cars are getting ready to go back on the track. ARCA cars still on the clock, but nobody is out on the track right now running as it is all quiet. Welcome back, everybody. 15 years ago, Darrell Waltrip provided one of the most memorable Daytona 500 moments when he won the Great American Race for the first time in his 17th try. Let's look back.
After 17 years of effort, the Daytona 500 belongs to Franklin, Tennessee's Darrell Waltrip. He's done it. He's done it.
We knew whenever Kenny broke away from us that we couldn't catch him. They were running too fast. So Darrell's automatically went to plan two and said, hey, let's draft everybody and anybody. And we just didn't worry about the speed. We just kept hanging in there. We knew the whole way to win this race. We had to beat him on mileage, and we did.
Daryl, how long?
Wait. This is the Daytona 500, isn't it? Don't kill me, isn't it? Thank God!
Oh, what a memorable moment that was. And by the way, that was a very young-looking Jeff Hammond and Mike Joy in that picture. But I think they were as excited as DW was about the whole thing.
Oh, they certainly were. You know, two things about that. We showed the 84 500. That's when America really got to understand that this was a fantasy sport, watching him control that car at 200 miles an hour. And 89 was the payoff. There was real fantasy there. There were a lot of folks cheering for Waltrip. And after all those years of trying to win this, he said he'd won the championship three times, and then he came to this race and he found out what winning really meant. To win the Daytona 500 was the fantasy.
All right, what a very exciting moment in Daytona 500 history. Time for us to pay some more bills, but we'll be back in 2 minutes as we get you ready to go running at the practice session for the Budweiser Shootout. We remind you, tickets are still available for all Speed Week's events, including the Great American Race itself. Just call 1-800-PIT-SHOP. Welcome back, everybody, to Speed Weeks on Speed, which is presented by LaVitra. Let's get you right back out to the garage area right now and join Bob Dillner, who's back again with Jeff Gordon.
That's right. I moseyed on over from the ARCA garage to the Nextel Cup garage here, and Robbie Loomis and Jeff Gordon kind of talking strategy here. Another practice session coming up, and I saw you in the white elephant, the phone booth, but I think I like you seeing you here better.
Yeah, I like the phone booth. I wasn't expecting you to be up there. I was, you know, just talking and hanging out.
So what were you talking about?
Just everything, man. Just kind of seeing, you know, seeing how John's doing. Hadn't seen him much over the off season, and seeing what's new. Talking about tires. Of course, everybody's talking about tires.
How about the new tires here? Of course, we're going to have a tech tip coming up here on the show. But, you know, the new tires, can you feel the difference here at Daytona?
Oh, yeah, definitely. I mean, you know, the cars move around a little bit more, and, you know, the handling goes away a little bit more. So, you know, I don't know if we're really going to get a clear indication in draft practice as we are once we get out there in the race. But we're learning a little bit about the wear. It's definitely a lot more. And, you know, I don't know if you're going to see many guys taking two tires.
Seventh fastest in that practice session. You had a little bit of a problem, but is that all resolved now?
Yeah, we got that figured out. You know, just had a little bit of a problem there. I felt bad for the guys behind us because we sprayed some oil on them, but no, the car's real good, you know, handling good. Speed, you know, really doesn't matter when you're in the draft. We really don't care about that. We care about how it sucks up, if we can pass, and really just how it handles.
Hey, how's the new dude going?
It's going good. How's yours doing?
Mine's not bad.
Mine's growing.
Mine's kind of coming back a little bit. I got the little boy bangs.
Yeah, well, I'm just glad to have some hair back. But I didn't think it was going to stir things up quite as much as it did. But it was fun.
Jeff Gordon always making noise here in the garage area, John.
All right, Bob Dillon and Jeff Gordon, thanks a lot. Now, there was a great deal of complaining going on last season about how Goodyear's harder tire made several NASCAR races come down to gas mileage. Tonight, Fox and Speed Channel analyst Larry McReynolds tells us this year has a softer tire sidewall, and that may make it harder to win on fuel strategy.
You know, one of the big complaints the last couple of years about NASCAR racing is we've not had any side-by-side racing. We have a lot of follow the leader. And especially late in the race, when a caution comes out, teams don't come to pit road anymore. They just stay out there and follow the leader on the tires that they have. A lot of the fans have complained about this. A lot of the veteran competitors have complained about this. Rusty Wallace has been very vocal about doing something to help the competition. These cars have become so aero-dependent that no longer are the tires and the chassis set up that big of an issue. So in 2004, NASCAR, along with the help of the Goodyear Tire and Rubber Company, has went to work on this, and it is a package deal. What Goodyear is doing is they are softening the compound of the tire up. It's going to grip the racetrack much better. It's going to give up a little quicker because it's gripping better, and it's going to start to slide around. Now, what they've also done, they've softened the left side tires up a little bit more than you did the right sides, because you can be a little more aggressive with the left sides because the right side tires are the one that takes all the abuse. But these tires are going to give up, so that means it's going to put a lot more in the driver's hand not to slide his car around when the car starts to get loose or starts to push. What NASCAR did to offset this, because if you just simply put softer tires on the car and didn't do anything else to go with it, they just run faster because they're gripping the corners better. So what NASCAR's done is they're going to take some rear downforce away from the car. They're not going to mess with the front of the car, but they're going to reduce the height of the rear spoiler. They're going to reduce it by 3/4 of an inch. In 2003, the height of this rear spoiler is 6 1/4 inches. In 2004, it's going to be reduced to 5 1/2 inches. Now, that's roughly going to take about 100 pounds of rear downforce away from this car. Now, NASCAR knows that teams will work hard to get part of that downforce back. This change is simply one phase of this. This don't mean that maybe even in the second half of 2004 that we may see even the rear spoiler reduced even more to go with a softer tire. Now, the hopes are that we will have more side-by-side racing, and I personally think in particular pit strategy is going to change. I think now, even late in the race when that caution comes out, that if you don't come to pit road and get four tires like we did several years ago, you could be in trouble for the end of that race.
All right, Larry McReynolds, thanks a lot. As the action continues in the garage area, the work goes on. More on-track action with the NASCAR Nextel Cup teams is coming your way tomorrow at 1:30, part of our 70 hours of coverage. Well, folks, it's time now to sign up for Fantasy Cup Racing 2004. You'll get your chance to compete for lots of prizes and have tons of fun following the action as your team as you manage a race team. It's the official fantasy game of Speed Channel. You can learn more by logging on to speedtv.com and looking for the banner at the top of the page. And there is a live, beautiful look at the garage area, which is buzzing with activity right now as we're just a few moments away from going back to practicing on track with the Nextel Cup cars. Now, 10 years ago, Sterling Marlin won the first of his two Daytona 500s. Here's another Speed Week's historic moment.
in front. Ernie Irvin closing ground. Here they come down the stretch for the final time. It is Sterling Marlin in the lead. Down to the inside comes the 28. Coming to the line. Sterling Marlin's going to win it.
Well, I knew if I ever got with a, you know, good race team, and I tell you, these boys worked awful hard all winter, and we come down here to win it, and I knew when I left house, we was going to win the race, and it wasn't looking too good early, but they done a heck of a job getting the car adjusted, and man, I love them.
Well, that's when Sterling Marlin was on top of his games on these super big racetracks, Ken. But also, that was Morgan McClure, which was showing some real strength on the big tracks.
Two great years. You know, it doesn't matter which year you select. When you get down to winning the Daytona 500, everybody says, which one is your favorite? Which is the... Every one of these races, as we move along toward the 46, is very, very special, and always for a different reason. But that one for Sterling Marlin, who had tried for so long, another one, living the fantasy and finally having it come to reality. What a special moment.
All right, ever since then, Sterling's been fighting to get back. He's come close.
Yep. And he can do it. I mean, he's proven he's really a great fast driver, and it takes a special kind of driver, I think, for these super speedways.
All right, Ken, another great moment from the 500. It's almost time for the NASCAR NEXTEL Cup teams to return to the track for another tune-up before tomorrow's Budweiser Shootout. There's Junior getting ready to go, and we'll be back in 2 minutes.
Speed Weeks on Speed Channel is presented by New Levitra. New choice, here now. Ask your doctor today.
Well, the cars are on pit road, ready to go. But before we go, let's get some final thoughts from our Speed broadcast crew, beginning with Bob Dillner.
John, Mark Martin back behind the wheel of his car, and he's doing a lot of hot dogging today, looking pretty good, fifth fastest on the speed chart. And I say hot dogging because he's got Oscar Mayer Wiener on the hood of his car. But you know what? Guess who he's sponsored by? He's sponsored by Viagra. Go figure. Then again, we're sponsored by Levitra. Ralph Shaheen?
Well, you know, I've got some experts together. This is my buddy Sean. He tells me that Dale Jr. is going to win, but my other pal Trace over here says, who's going to win tomorrow?
Tony Stewart.
Tony Stewart. There you have it. Dale Jr. or Tony Stewart's going to win the Bud Shootout tomorrow, according to our new Speed Channel experts.
All right, Ralph Shaheen, thanks a lot. Ken Squire, your final thoughts today.
All right. 26th occasion. Three times it's been won back-to-back. Schrader did it, 83, 84, the great Neil Bonnet, and more recently, Tony Stewart. From 19th position, it was Dale Earnhardt Jr. last year, and I think he's going to put it all together tomorrow night. Going to be some race.
All right, it always is under the lights. It is quite a shootout spectacle. Now, we hope you're enjoying our Speed Weeks coverage on Speed Channel, which is presented by Levitra. We'll be here in our studio above Victory Lane to bring you all the action from the World Center of Racing. NEXTEL Cup practice for the Budweiser Shootout is next. It is time now to send it back up top to Mike, Larry, and Jeff. We'll be back in an hour.
Live to Daytona International Speedway, like a jewel in the Florida night sky. This place is more brightly lit than the adjacent airport. And some of NASCAR's fastest of 2003 are about to take to the track in round two of Bud Shootout practice. Unlike the afternoon session in 85 degree temperatures, now these drivers and their crew chiefs will get a chance to experience what they'll expect tomorrow evening when the Bud Shootout is run under the lights. Kevin Harvick, quickest in the afternoon session. And a lot of new color right there, like Mark Martin's brightly painted sponsor festooned car. Dave Burns has more.
Well, and you know, Mike, have you ever had noisy neighbors? Have you had noisy neighbors, Mike?
Not that I'll admit to on national TV.
Thank you. Exactly.
Or I'll have more.
That's a very smart answer. Well, Mark Martin's garage area was one of the noisiest down here between their practice sessions this afternoon. sawing away, sanding away, all kinds of noise. And I came back a little while later and looked at the front fenders, and there was nothing on there. So I went to Pat Trison to find out, Pat, if I see nothing on top, where was all the sanding and grinding and sawing going on? Underneath, right?
Yeah, we were trying some adjustments with some aero stuff underneath that's trying to make it a little more downforce to make it turn just a little bit better. He just needs a little more grip getting in. And, so we tried some stuff on some underneath stuff that we know should help front downforce.
And is that stuff you've tried in the wind tunnel and know you could do, or was that sort of like, let's think about some stuff and try it?
It's some stuff that we've done in the wind tunnel. It's not as good drag-wise, but it makes a little more downforce, so you give up a little bit to get a little bit.
All right, and as the cars roll, let's go to Matt.
And the Bud guy's waiting for Junior Dale Jr. to pull off, munching on some macaroni and cheese here at the back of the trailer. And Tony Sr., how would you describe that first session? I mean, there was some smoking tires, some vibrations.
Yeah, the car's real tight. Just can't get them to turn. Everybody in the garage is having a problem. The cars won't turn. They turn the right front tires off of them. Balance is just way off on the car. They got so much spoiler on the back of them. So we changed a bunch of A-arms, changed gears, drive shafts, trying to get rid of the vibration. And I'm not even sure that's what it is. Might be the tires vibrating. I don't know. But he said that the cars are so tight they haven't let off the gas like they had a short track to get through the corner. So hopefully it'll be better.
Making this final session even more important, Mike Joy.
Thanks, Matt. Not only is it a new year at Daytona, there are new rules and nuances of these cars to adapt to. So I've got Larry McReynolds and Jeff Hammond alongside to explain it all to you. Tony Urey looked like he has a lot of work yet to do.
Well, this is the same rule package that they ran at Talladega back in October, the same height rear spoiler with that bigger restrictor plate. The problem is, we say it every year, Daytona is not Talladega. Daytona is a handling racetrack, and what Tony's saying, I even heard it in Pat Trison, what he was describing about Martin's cars, the cars are not going to turn. Now, the bad news is the track's cooling down, and they're going to want to turn less, Jeff Hammond, because, you know, you've got more grip, and the cars are going to push more and more as you get more laps on the tires.
Definitely so. As the fuel burns off these race cars, more nose weight goes to the front of the car. That's going to be a problem. You saw right there, I think, the two car, the rest of the wall, this car's already hitting the racetrack. Again, this is one of those situations where tonight's practice, even though they got 1 hour to get everything done, they've got to get it done right. And the guys that were good early on, you got to be conscious of the fact that this is not a daytime race. You've got to tune it for the night and cooler track conditions.
But wait a minute. I thought we just opened the track for 1 hour of practice. This looks like they just dropped the green flag. This is not practice. This is race simulation right here.
Well, that's exactly what you're going to see tomorrow night, Mike, and that's what these guys are trying to get geared up for right now. This is the way it's going to happen when they get through picking their positions. You got to remember, nobody knows where they're starting, so you got to figure out how good your car is, no matter whether you're up front or whether you're in the back. This is the best time to understand the balance of your race car.
Our Fox colleague Darrell Walker will host the draw for position later this evening to find out where they'll start tomorrow night in the Bud Shootout. There is no speed qualifying for the Bud Shootout. It's always been determined by a draw among the eligible drivers. Now, Elliott Sadler, who posted the, how shall I say it, least fastest speed this afternoon, is the first car on track in that monochrome paint scheme, M&M number 38. And yet he's been out front ever since they dropped the rag and opened the track.
But they know the speed chart in practice is deceiving, because it's all in how you're lined up. Maybe you've got a group catching a group and the speed's going to shoot way up. We know we interviewed him in that first practice. He was very happy the way that car was driving. And sometimes when it's driving good and you know it's good, the safest place is in that garage here.
And that's where Boris Sett was until just now. He's going to pull out, try to join this pack. 17 of the 19 eligible drivers have been on track and made laps in this nighttime practice. Now, this afternoon was acclimation, tweaking, getting your car right. This is the real deal for tomorrow night.
It really is, Michael. This is what these guys are looking at right now. They've gone in, they've done all these adjustments. They've anticipated track conditions as far as temperature is concerned. They've made the adjustments like Tony Senior was talking about on Dale Earnhardt's car. All these guys have got these things tweaked out, put four brand new tires on it, filled it full of fuel, and said, okay, let's go run us a segment here and see how our car responds.
Has the fastest lap early in this second practice session for the Bud Shootout. We're live on speed. Don't move. Speed Channel coverage of Bud Shootout practice is brought to you by New LaVitra. New choice, here now. Ask your doctor today. They've all been out there. jostling for position. And the pack has now kind of broken in two. And the driver who had the quick time, Bobby Labonte, now second. Dale Earnhardt Jr. is now fastest. But don't let these times deceive you, because many of these quick times are from a car that is back off of some cars as he comes by and then sucks up to the pack the next time by. So his lap time is quicker than, let's say, the car at the front of the pack on that lap. And so it goes.
You know, Mike, this can be a real challenge for these guys, what they're trying to do here. They're trying to make a long run with these cars. Remember, tomorrow night's race is 70 laps. They're going to run 20 laps, then a 10-minute break to do normal pit stop adjustments and procedures, fuel and tires, then 50 laps. We know they will have to make at least one pit stop in that 50 laps for fuel because of the smaller fuel cells. But right now, what they're trying to do, most of them are going to be trying to overcome an aero push by fixing it with chassis things, and that's hard to do because you can't make the rear spoiler smaller. The size is mandated, and you can't take degrees out because the degrees is mandated. So it can be a real challenge what these guys are trying to do here in the adjust zone.
And Jeff, that pit stop, most of the drivers we heard from in the last session said it'll be a four-tire stop. They won't gamble with two.
No, that's true. They already figured out right now that they need to have the grip from the new tires and everything. So pit stop is going to be very critical tomorrow, getting off pit road, not tearing anything up, and at the same time having a really smooth stop and making the necessary adjustments as quickly as possible.
To the garage, Mark Martin. Dave Burns is there.
And Mike, his crew pushed his car in, but not to worry. It was a clean cut of the engine. They went out there and met him, pushed the car in. Mark uttered a few statements over the radio that were very, very positive. And I asked crew chief Pat Tryson, did he say the car was perfect? And he said, yeah. No, he didn't say it was perfect. Yeah, I think he did say the P word.
Mark's very happy right now.
But I'm going to tell you, Dave, if I'm his crew chief, Pat Tryson, if you're happy now, you've only run five laps, go out there and run me about 15 or 20 more, and if you're still happy. And what they mean by a clean cut, what Mark did down the backstretch at full throttle, he reached up and shut the engine down. It gets a clean cut on the engine where Jack Roush and those engine guys can look at the spark plugs and tell a lot about the distribution of the engine and needing to adjust jetting or something of that nature of the carburetor.
And one reason that's very important this year on this night is NASCAR has changed fuel suppliers. The 76 Competition 110 racing gasoline, 110 octane, has been replaced. NASCAR is a new fuel supplier this year, Sunoco, with a 112 octane fuel that has a very different componentry than the fuel it replaced. So all of these engine builders are being very cautious and want to get get some checks so they know exactly what they're dealing with, because tuning these engines is different with a different fuel.
And I think we add one more thing to that, Mike, is the fact that what you're alluding to is the temperature as well as the air density itself at night is so much different than what it is during the day can affect all this as far as the fuel mixture is concerned. So it's better to be safe than sorry.
Most of this pack right here, they're up there at about that 10 or 11 lap mark in this run. This would be about halfway through the first segment tomorrow night.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. with the quickest lap of this 1 hour practice session, and you're going to see it all right here on Speed. You asked for it, we're going to give it to you trackside in front of a live audience. The first such show will be next Friday, right next to Daytona USA. Come on by, 7 o'clock. We'll catch it live right here on Speed. Trackside.
See the 10 car there kind of in the middle of the pack. Now that's the car that will be driven by Scott Riggs in the NEXTEL Cup Series all year long, running for Rookie of the Year. But how you get in this race right here is if you sit on a Bud pole last year in 2003, or if you're a past winner of the Bud Shootout. Mike Skinner, he's in the 10 car. He sat on the pole last year driving for not this race team, but the teammate to this team, the 01 car at Richmond. So they elected to put Mike in this team car right here because Boris Said, who sat on the pole at Infineon in the 01 car, that's the car he's driving here.
And we did get a clarification that apparently you must not only still be an active NEXTEL Cup driver if you're a past winner of this race, but need to finish so far up in the point standings the previous year to be able to use that past winner's slot, as Mark Martin has. There are two drivers who are eligible for this race, but who do not have rides for tomorrow night. One is Steve Park, and the other is Jeff Green. Jeff Green drives for the Petties, and Richard Richard Petty's cars do not carry the Budweiser decal and thus do not compete. And Jeff Green either was unable or declined to try and pick up another ride for the race because as a driver, he is eligible.
And I think we need to point out that that's something that the Petty's have done forever. Since the inception of this, we just did not believe it was a good thing for them to be involved in because obviously we just don't really believe in the beer sponsorship situation. And, I mean, I respect them for that. But it's unfortunate for Jeff Green. He didn't earn the right beat to participate.
Dave Burns.
Mike, I caught the end of Rusty Wallace's conversation with his crew as he's bringing the car in. Just a little bit tight. He said, let's throw a little setup on it and see what we get. Right front spring has been changed, a left side track bar adjustment, and they're going to take it back out there. Rusty didn't sound too concerned, just wanted to try something a little different. I think they're going to put change of spring rubbers in the right rear as well.
And you're so limited to the chassis adjustments you can make here because of the NASCAR rules. NASCAR says you can't run softer than 350-pound rear springs. The softer the springs are, the more you'll get the sport out of there. You can stiffen them, and I think a lot of them will be stiffed in that right rear spring to help them turn. The front springs are wide open. I got a feeling that they're probably going to soften that right front spring. You can play with the front sway bar, but the rear shocks are mandated. You cannot change the rear shocks. You can only change the combination of the front shocks.
A couple of new fellas out there. There's Morris Sett in the 01 at the tail of that pack who won the pole at Infinium. Dave Blaney is in the 23 for the Shootout. And we'll be right back. Speed Weeks rolls on speed. The ARCA stock car race, the 200-miler here at Daytona tomorrow, 3:30 p.m. live. Bobby Gerhardt on the pole, Kyle Busch alongside, and you'll see it here on speed.
Always an exciting race.
What we just saw will take your breath. Watch this.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the 8 car. He was not quite clear of Mike Skinner in the 10 car and came down, and that's a big part of the spotter shoulders up there, Jeff.
He really is, and you don't realize how close he came to getting turned sideways right there. I mean, good job of driving by Dale Earnhardt Jr. as well as, you know, Mike Skinner, both that did the right thing to get crazy with the steering wheel. But let's point out, Dale Earnhardt Jr. has got a new spotter. It's not normally his regular spotter. Stevie Reeves is up on top here right there with the car camera. He had to lift a little bit, but, I mean, that was close, wasn't it, Matt?
It was close. Stevie Reeves, a veteran spotter here in NEXTEL Cup Series competition, just calling out, clear high, clear low, you got one on the outside. Junior really never said anything about the incident on the radio. Shortly before he went to commercial, he came on the radio and said the car sucks up much better, meaning it pulls up to the pack. He also says the car is not quite as tight. Tony Jr., his car chief at Cousins, said, all right, so you can suck back up to the pack and pull it in. He said, no, sir, I want to see if I can pass everybody. He says, all right, when you do that, then bring it in. And that's basically what he's doing now. He's trying to see if he can suck up and work his way through the pack and just see how good that Bud Chevy really is.
And, Matt, what he's done here, he's ran 22 laps, which is good because that's 2 laps more than that first segment, so he knows what to expect tomorrow night in that first run of 20 laps, plus that's almost half the distance of the second segment when they know they'll probably be coming to pit road for fuel, four tires, and adjustments.
I tried to pinch myself down in front of the 10, but spun my car out by factor in pretty hard. But I was trying to squeeze him down. I was waiting on my spotter to tell me he wasn't backing out or he was going to. He kind of got about turned around there. His car did it.
This is part of the learning curve and the communication process between spotter and driver. What do I expect you to say? What do I want you to tell me? Where do I want to hear from you? Where don't I? It's a long process to expect that that's going to happen real quickly. And you heard Dale Jr. talk about what he wanted to hear.
Yeah, and I mean, Matt, this is happening out there at over 190 miles per hour.
Larry Mack, but this is exactly what Stevie Reeves wanted. He told me yesterday afternoon, I have worked with Dale Jr. before. 4 times we've worked together in the past, but he said, I really want to get some good practice time in to know what he wants, how he wants me to clear, how he wants me to tell him he's got cars around him, and how I can help him move through the pack. And he was really looking forward to tonight's practice session, especially at night, which will be very similar to conditions tomorrow night in the Bud Shootout, just to work on that communication between spotter and driver.
So in that case, what Dale Jr. was hoping to hear was still there.
Yes.
Words to that effect.
Yeah, I mean, most drivers, I know doing what little bit of spotting I've done, I did a lot for Wally Dallenbach last year, they want to constantly know what's going on because you're their eyes. They're in there. They have those headrests on both sides of them. They want that reassurance that it's clear or either they're still there because if you're not saying anything, it makes them unsure.
And in that driver cocoon, with all of the netting and the wide, long headrests that are used by the drivers now, they can't look outside the car to the left or the right and clear themselves anymore.
No, basically they've got blinders on, Mike, and that's the reason why this spotter is so important. And that comfort level you're trying to achieve is so critical because you've got to be able to have the confidence that he's basically in that car with you, helping you drive and get through things that you can't do anything about. You need to be focused on looking out the front windshield, and he should be giving you the clear. But also, you heard Dale Jr. say, I was trying to squeeze him down a little bit to see where he's at, and it almost cost him and Mike Skinner both. So, I mean, that's playing a little bit of a game of chicken out here tonight. It just about got both of them in trouble.
Rusty Wallace, Jeremy Mayfield, Elliott Sadler. As Bud Shootout practice rolls on here on Speed. Speed Channel coverage of Bud Shootout practice is brought to you by Helzberg Diamonds. Their value promise means you'll get their best price first time every time. Helzberg Diamonds. Confidence comes in a burgundy box. Dale Jr. paces round two of Bud Shootout practice. Kevin Harvick, Jamie McMurray, Jimmy Johnson, the top five practice speeds. As cars go in and out of the garage. Most laps, Dale Jr. and Jeff Gordon, 22 apiece. Least laps, Mark Martin went in the garage after five. Matt?
And Dale Jr.'s car up on jack stands making some changes. First off, Jr., a little scary moment over there with a car which you thought actually had a young driver in it, didn't you?
Yeah, I thought it was that other boy from the Bush series. Used to drive a 10 car back there.
Riggs.
Yeah, Riggs. I can't never remember their names, but I thought it was him, but it's Skinner. I'd have probably known better than to do it around Skinner. But, yeah, I was stuck on the outside. I was trying to get back to the inside, and wasn't nobody cut me no slack. So I figured I'd try to make it happen. It just, that wasn't the right thing to do either.
How is the communication going between yourself and Stevie Reeves? Are you happy so far?
Yeah, he'd spot for me before, and I was real happy with him then. And I think he's going to do a fine job. I'm definitely going to miss Ty, but Stevie's, I think Kyle didn't tell you, Stevie's a great spotter, and his background and his driving experience is going to help me a lot, too.
And you said you wanted to say something to somebody?
Yeah, I wanted to give a shout-out to all the DMP board, Kevin King, Denayer, all the peeps on FLM. Want to give them a what's up. They're probably all watching right now, so take it easy.
And they'll be good to know, glad to know that the vibration that Junior was talking about and that Tony Sr. was talking about at the beginning of the show is now gone. Dave?
And Matt, we heard his shout out to Scott Riggs as well, who of course is not in the car right now. It is Mike Skinner. Scott standing by here watching the activity of his team down here. Last time you were in the car was testing. Now you're watching and listening. What are you picking up from the activity?
Just watching. The good thing about it, both the Valvoline cars were about the same. They sort of reacted the same changes we were down here testing. So hopefully everything that we can learn here in the shootout with Mike in the car, we can sort of transfer over to the 500 car. Feel good about it so far.
We talk a lot about communication. Is it using his own spotter, or is it the same voice that you're going to be hearing with your 500 car?
It's actually our spotter, our team, everybody, you know, making the call here. So it's good. It's good to see how the guys work right now. It's good to be sort of outside the box right now, seeing what's going on, listen to another driver, the way that he explains the car, and get a little more feedback. And like I said, hopefully everything we learn here, we can transfer over to the 500 car.
Days, got to get to do this himself for real in the 10 car. Mike?
Now we'll see him tomorrow morning in NEXTEL Cup practice right here on Speed Channel. Now, I didn't make notes of what Dale Earnhardt Jr. said, but I think DMP I can translate to Dirty Mo Posse, all his buddies there in Mooresville. And Ty Norris, who was general manager of Dale Earnhardt Incorporated until just about 1 week ago. He also spotted for Dale Jr. as part of his duties with the company, and he's no longer with them.
Yeah, I mean, other than Stevie Reeves doing a little bit of spotting for Dale Earnhardt Jr., which Stevie mainly spotted for Steve Parton in one car, Ty Norris's voice has been in Dale Earnhardt's ear not only during his NEXTEL Cup career, but also when he ran the Bush Series car for 2 years, so he's been there a long time as his spotter.
Now, you're talking about his voice. Did you hear it, Larry? He sounded to me like a confident guy, having some fun out there. Got a pretty good race car, so you better watch out for that cat. Whenever he's smiling, everybody else better beware.
Oh, yeah.
Taylor Earnhardt Jr. continues to have the fastest lap of this one-hour practice session. You're watching it on Speed Channel. We'll be right back. Next Friday, 8 p.m., live from here at Daytona International Speedway. Opening round of the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series, always exciting. And now it's Chevy, Ford, Dodge, Toyota as they open the season. Don't miss it next Friday night live. It is a full moon Friday night here in Daytona Beach. Now, if we were short tracking,
that would mean at the moon for a long time.
I know he has. That would mean trouble, because full moons and short track racing usually means calamity and multiple caution flags. Tomorrow night, of course, under the lights, the Bud Shootout. That full moon will be up there high in the sky. We'll see what happens.
And it'll be just like a short track tomorrow night when everything's all said and done, because these guys, a lot of them know, I'm not going to run this car to 500. All I'm going to do is try to win this race and make all the money I can.
That's Bill Elliott in that 91. New number for Bill, who's going to run a part-time NEXTEL Cup schedule. This is an Evernham car, much like he's been driving for Ray for the past couple of seasons. But he is going to run the Shootout tomorrow night and then not compete in the Daytona 500 for the first time in about a quarter century.
Since 1980. It was since that time right there. He's been running all of them since then.
Yeah, his next race right now, tentatively planned, is Las Vegas. Had a great test out there a couple of weeks ago. And I talked to Bill yesterday at Media Day here at Daytona International Speedway. And he's having fun. You know, he's having fun with his limited schedule. He's having fun doing driver coaching for Casey Kane. I know they went to Rockingham and tested here a few weeks ago. I was talking to Ray Evernham. And Ray said, Bill called me about lunchtime and said, let me tell you something. This kid's got it.
So Bill Elliott may be going the way of Buddy Baker, the man who won the first Busch Clash, now the Bud Shootout, as Buddy coached Ryan Newman, and now his new protege is Brendan Gaughan for the 2004 season.
It's hard to believe this will be the 26th annual running of the Busch Clash, the Bud Shootout, the Budweiser Shootout.
You know what you need to call it, guys? We always talk about the Daytona 500 being the Super Bowl of our racing series. It's our Pro Bowl.
Yes.
All these guys right here are the top of the top when it comes to qualifying and getting the job done. For 26 years, we've been having our Pro Bowl before the Super Bowl.
Credit a Busch Beer marketing executive named Monty Roberts for creating what was then the Busch Clash, a race among the pole winners of the prior season. And here is Elliott in this unfamiliar number 91 car, the winner of the 87 Clash.
And we talked earlier, one of the ways you get in the Bud Shootout forever is basically if you win the Bud Shootout, we have about six past winners, and Bill Elliott's one of those, that he did not sit on a pole in 2003. And also last year's winner of the Bud Shootout, Dale Earnhardt Jr., he did not win a pole last year. Started almost dead last year to come back and win that race. That's how he's in the race this year.
Yep, came from 19th, the furthest back anybody has come in starting position to win this.
And I think we need to point out also, as we see Bill Elliott going around in the number 91 car, people are going to say, well, why didn't Bill finish his career in the number 9? Well, last year, they go back to points again. The 9 car on the points go to Ray Evernham. They've got a young rookie in the car like they've got right now. In case they need a provisional or whatever, car owner folks will play in his favor. And that way, this rookie gets the benefit of the number 9 number as far as the car owner is concerned. At least for the first, was it, Larry, first 5 races, 4 to 5 races that we run.
First 4.
So that I'm sure that's one of the biggest reasons why Bill elected to go to the 91 and they kept the 9 with Casey Kane.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. still quickest as Bill Elliott heads for the garage. And we'll be right back with more from Daytona. Ball-to-wall practice for the NASCAR NEXTEL Cup Series. Here from Daytona at 1:30 p.m. live tomorrow.
All that work over the winter, ever since, well before even, Homestead, Miami. Comes down to those 2 laps tomorrow, getting ready to qualify for the Daytona 500.
Well, What I love about this time of year is you walk through that garage area and every driver has a strong shot to win the championship. You don't believe it, just ask them. And every crew chief and every car owner.
That's the attitude you're supposed to roll in here with.
I was getting ready to say, if you didn't have that kind of attitude, you know what happens? You ought to be fired and just run right out of the garage here, because everybody has worked their tails off to get ready to come to Daytona and basically put your four best opportunities out there as far as this Bud Shootout, qualifying, the 125 and the 500. You've had a lot of racing.
Safe.
Jeremy Mayfield is heading back out, guys. I talked to Jeremy while he was in. Just little changes, he said. They made a carburetor adjustment. They worked just a little bit on the handling as well. And meanwhile, his 500 car has been through tech as well today, and a few adjustments going on here. So side by side, while they're working on the car on the track, the Shootout car, the 500 car is getting ready to go on the track tomorrow.
And Dave, that paint scheme on Jeremy's Bud Shootout car, it is representative of the official logo of the 2004 NHL All-Star Game that's going on this weekend in St. Paul, Minnesota. There it is. A lot happening up there with the hockey group this week.
I bet you didn't know that somebody that works with us actually played hockey, very good at it, is Alan Bestwick. Alan Bestwick was a great hockey player.
Really?
Yes. You ought to see him on skates.
Huh.
Very good.
Matt.
And someone also very good with a stick, or at least a hammer, that's Adam Meyer, the head fabricator at RCR. He's working on that left front fender of Kevin Harvick Chevrolet. It was rubbing a little bit. They did have the hammer beating away on it, trying just to massage it a little bit. And Larry Mack, you were talking about his expertise, much like an artist working with sheet metal.
Yeah, I don't call guys like Adam Meyer a fabricator. I call him a craftsman. But I think we're seeing a lot of people having to beat these front fenders up. And I think what's happening, we've heard throughout this practice session about the cars not turning and developing that push where it's not turning off the corner. And one thing you can do to overcome it is keep softening those front springs, maybe especially that left front spring. Of course, the more you soften them, the more the car travels and it hits the top of the fenders.
How do you estimate back at the shop when you set a car up, how much compression that spring is going to give and how much clearance you're going to have left? Or is that something you really can't tell until you get to the racetrack?
Well, what happens is with the telemetry that the guys have at their access today, is they're able to go out there and run around the racetrack and check that travel when the cars go in the race, all the way around the racetrack, no matter what's in the corner, coming off the corner. They know approximately how far the left front spring, as well as the right front, right rear, left rear, all these springs, and how close the chassis is to the ground. And they're able to simulate that back at the shop, and that really has helped a lot of these fabricators today to be able to build these fenders with the right amount of clearance.
But one thing that's throwing them a little bit of a curve, Mike, this new tire combination by Goodyear, not only is it a little softer compound, especially on the right side, it's a softer sidewall. The tire's flexing around more. It makes you have to have a little more clearance not only in your front fender, but in your quarter panels.
Kind of like the old bias plot days, exactly what these guys are running into. And a lot of these younger mechanics have never seen the bias plot, so they haven't understand how much it moves around.
There's a Dave Blaney pulling off at the 23. He's headed for the garage. Elliot Sadler is in the garage right now. Dave's with us.
Standing outside his car, guys, and you're done going home.
Yeah, I think we've got all the speed we can get out of this M&M's full tour, so it's very good. It was great the first practice. We tried a little something at the beginning, the second, didn't like it, put it back like we had, and it's fast, it's comfortable. The guys have definitely done their homework, the motor shop and the fab shop, so I'm pretty excited about tomorrow. I'm looking to have a good time and moving around a little bit, doing some bump drafting, and just having a good time.
You like your car better? I strongly like it in the draft, Elliot.
It's led a lot of laps today in practices. I don't know if that's where we need to be. I tried to fall back some, but it was pretty fast, so I kind of wanted to go back to the front again. But it definitely likes lean. It's a lot of fun out there leading like we've been able to do, and the guys got a great fuel mileage check, so we think we got everything that we need to have. We prepared as good as we can be for tomorrow night. We just want to make a good showing. We want to get all those dedicated Robert Yates fans something to cheer about starting here tomorrow night.
That's right. And of course, it wants to be up front on the correct lap at the end.
No kidding. Well, Dale Jr. still has the fastest practice speed. Bobby Labonte, Kevin Harvick, Jamie McMurray, Jimmy Johnson, and Dave Blaney are the quickest half dozen thus far. Fantasy Cup Auto Racing is now the official fantasy game of Speed Channel. Select your team of 8 NEXTEL Cup drivers. Score weekly points. Stay within your budget. To enter, simply log on to speedtv.com and click on the Fantasy Cup Auto Racing banner at the top of the page. Grand prize winner receives $25,000, and there's more than $750,000 at stake in 2004.
Got a pretty good group of cars gathering back out there again. We're getting down here in the final 15 minutes of this practice session. This will be the final practice before we shoot out tomorrow.
13 of the 19 cars on track. Elliott Sadler headed for the house, as he told us. And Ryan Newman rolling out of the throttle as his teammate Rusty Wallace goes to the front.
And just remember one thing when you do watch the butt shootout tomorrow is remember that yellow line all the way around the bottom of this racetrack, that's out of bounds. You cannot go below that yellow line and advance your position. We've had a lot of issues with that over the last couple of years. So that's something, especially in that short race tomorrow night, that NASCAR will be watching very closely.
Chevy, Dodge, Ford, Chevrolet in that front group with Dale Jarrett's 88 and Kevin Harvick in the 29 and Boris Said right there in the 01 Army Chevrolet. The road race veteran getting a taste of Daytona-style super speedway traffic.
And Boris is just trying to do what he did in earlier practice, just log laps in this thing, you know, put that car in different positions. He's never really ran a speedway. In fact, even when he sat on the pole, Mike, at Infineon in June, NASCAR has a criteria for drivers to race at Daytona or Talladega, so they highly suggested you maybe need to run the ARCA race at Talladega in October, so that's what this group did for him to get him that experience and for NASCAR to give him that seal of approval to race here tomorrow night.
Dave?
When they pull out the cleaning materials and start wiping down the car, you know they're pretty close to done. Carrie Labonte has stepped out. And how was your car at the end?
Well, I think it was pretty good. You know, it's handling good and seems to be running pretty good. So we not really much point in just out there riding around, I guess. We really couldn't think of anything else to try to make it any better because we felt like it was pretty close. So we'll just have to see what we have tomorrow night.
Is there any place other than the front to be on the last lap in this configuration?
It depends how many guys are lined up behind you, but at the first, if you're first, this is going to be the best place to be, unless there's only two or three guys, you know, in the lead pack. I think if there's, you know, a big pack of cars, that's like there probably will be, then I think first is the place to be. But I think if you are first, there's only three or four of them behind you, they could line up and pass you. But if there's too many behind you, they won't do it, so, because they're going to all start racing each other.
Very hard for this last 50-lap shootout tomorrow night, guys.
Terry Labonte, Richmond pole winner and winner of the final Labor Day Southern 500. He won the Butt Shootout with class 1985.
And you know, one reason I think you're going to want to be out front or leading at the end of this race, especially at the end of a long run when the tires are really wore out and these cars are pushing worse and worse, is being out front is going to make that car turn the best because you've got all the air on the front end. You know, if you're behind them, you've lost that front downforce.
Jeff Hammond with the winner of the first Busch Clash.
That's right, Mike. We come outside here to the spotter stand, and guess who I found? I found Brendan Gaughan, which is contending for the Rookie of the Year, but I also found the guys teaching him. As you said earlier, he won the first Busch Clash. That's Buddy Baker. Buddy, what's going on up here tonight?
Well, Brendan's really catching on quick about the draft and all. Of course, he ran the truck race here last year and did a fine job, but little tricks that he's watching Ryan Newman and Rusty Wallace doing when they're working together. The three of them ought to be dynamic if they really work together and not against each other. That's what I'm telling him, and he's real quick on that. And I will tell you this, tremendous amount of ability here. You're going to hear a lot about Brendan Gaughan this year.
Well, buddy, let me ask you this. You had a lot to do with, as far as Ryan Newman's concerned. How does he compare to Ryan?
Well, they're different people completely, and Ryan Newman is pretty quiet about what he does, and Brendan Gaughan, but he gets the job done, and you know, it's just a different style. Both of them have their own way of doing things, but I still work with Ryan Newman here in Daytona. I'll be on the back straightaway spotting for him, but I also keep an eye on Brendan. We tested together down here and did a fine job. We're very quick. I'm looking for him. By the way, he put a little money on himself for the Daytona 500. That's how proud he is of what he can do.
What about that, Brandon?
You know, Buddy Baker having the coach here, right, you know, has really helped me a ton. We are trying to watch Rusty and Ryan. I mean, those are my teammates, trying to watch the moves they're making. And you can see when they worked together that last couple seconds, you can see how much better they worked together, how much faster their Dodges became. They went right to the front of that pack. This whole deal is, you know, it's not about teamwork when you're running. It's just about picking the right spots, picking and choosing, and being committed when you do it. And I'm committed to following Rusty and Ryan. They're my teammates. Rusty's my boss, and Ryan's got a lot of wins. So I could finish third behind them and make Penske 1-2-3 and be just pretty darn happy.
What about all year long? I mean, how things are going to be as far as that's concerned? Is it starting to come to you that you are now in the NEXTEL Cup?
I'm having a lot of fun. You know, I'm always exciting, Jeff, and I'm always excitable, and I'm still having fun. I'm still excited. You know, to actually have a sponsor wearing the Kodak stuff here means the world, that to actually be able to talk about a product and represent great people and great companies. And that's what you have with Kodak, Penske, and Jasper's. Great people, great companies. So it's true. I love talking about the people. So I'm just excited. We're going to have fun.
Well, talking about one of the teammates of this Penske operation, I believe Matt Yoakum's caught up with Ryan Newman.
Ryan Newman says patient in his race car, and you've spoken many times about the advantage of having someone like Buddy Baker in your corner.
Yeah, Buddy's an awesome guy, both on and off the racetrack, and he's helped us out a lot, and a lot of thanks go to him. And to have him helping us out down here at Daytona means a whole lot to me personally, and you know, it does make this race car go faster, so that's definitely cool.
Now, a big learning curve for your teammate, Brandon, but what about yourself? Now that you've got some time in the seat, does he still bring up things from time to time that maybe fine-tune your driving style or maybe what you're doing?
If you know Buddy, he's not afraid to tell you what's right from wrong, and it definitely does help us out still. And, you know, thankfully, I've learned some things, so it's not as much as the first time he came here to Daytona, but, you know, I know he'll be a good help to Brendan and Gaughan also.
Quickly grade your car, scale of 1 to 10 on sucking up, and is it better out front or in the back?
I'd say it's 5 in all respects right now. We got a pretty average race car, so just trying to see what we can do to make it a 6 or a 5.5, and go from there.
Engineer always talking about numbers, guys.
Well, Newman and Gaughan join a list of Baker proteges that include Ron Bouchard and Jimmy Spencer.
He has given a lot of them a good education. Yeah. Now, you better believe it. When it come to Daytona and Talladega, you knew Buddy Baker was pushing his foot through the floorboard.
Every time. Dale Jr., Bobby Labonte, Kevin Harvick, Jamie McMurray, and Jimmy Johnson are fast in this practice session. Speed Channel coverage of Bud Shootout practice is brought to you by New Levitra. New choice, here now. Ask your doctor today. Full moon Friday night at Daytona International Speedway. Don't need the moonlight. This place is lit by hundreds of thousands of candle power. And there's Dave Blaney leading Jamie McMurray and Bill Elliott around the speedway. Here's Dave Burns.
Mark Martin standing by here, just hopped out of the 6 car. And Mark, we started the show talking with your crew chief about, you know, secret stuff underneath the fenders and changing things under there. Did it make any difference?
It would fly before and it'll fly now.
Is that, are you happy with it?
It's the fastest car I've had at Daytona in years and years. I'm so proud of this whole team, and maybe we can put this craft car out front a little bit tomorrow night.
Was it better for you leading the pack, or did you feel like staying back coming around?
Way better leading the pack, and it would do that. Once you get there, it would stay there very well, you know, better than anything I've had in years. Proud of this Ford Power under the hood and this new Taurus, and Pat and all the guys, Todd and all these guys that work on this car, built a brand new car and tested for the shootout here, and we've had a good practice. We're finished.
Sounds like Mark will be in the mix tomorrow night. Matt?
Kevin Harvick's also done for the night. 25 laps in the first session, 29 this session. Kevin, great new car.
We got a handle a lot better. Actually, a little bit free right now, so we're just kind of fooling around with some stuff, trying to make it just a little bit better. But so far, the GM Goodrich Chevrolet's pretty good, and have to wait and see what happens tomorrow.
Is your car like to lead or follow better?
We haven't actually led yet. We've just been trying to stay in traffic and make our car handle good and really concentrate on making sure it pulls up, handles, does everything it needs to do, and if it can pull to second, it'll be able to lead fine.
Now, the best average you finished by any driver last year on the Ford plate races isn't Michael Walsh or Dale Earnhardt Jr. It was you with finishes of second through ninth. It seems like you've really improved on your plate racing.
Yeah, I think Mike Skinner said it the best. I couldn't draft my way out of a second 11. the first year and a half or so, but I still make some mistakes, and that's why we're trying to practice more than we need to do and just get ourselves tuned up and get all the winter bugs out.
It's all about learning. He certainly has learned a lot, Larry Mack.
Yeah, and I mean, that average finish, that came with this car that he's racing in the Bud Shootout, because this is the car that he ran all four restrictor plate races with last year. But you know what, Jeff, if that car's a little bit free, not loose, just a little free with the way everybody's going with their chassis set up, the way these cars are going on a long run, a little free at the beginning, if you can hang on, might not be bad.
I think it'd be the best way you could start right now, because again, we're talking about the racetrack maybe being a little bit cooler again, more than what it is tonight. I mean, another maybe 10 or 15 degrees, which again could make cars have that much more grip. So being free, like you're saying, Larry, would be a really good way to start the race.
Car. He has run some laps. He's ran 39 laps, so he's just about 10 laps shy of the length of the second segment of 50 laps.
Yeah, he and Dave Blaney lead the league in laps run in this second practice session. It is the first Bud Shootout for both of them.
Jamie was a late entry, won the last Bud Pole of 2003 down at Homestead Miami Speedway in November. But this is good. This is what I would encourage my driver and my group to do, is let's run as many laps as we can. We have to find out what this car is going to be like at the end of a long run if we're going to be there at the end tomorrow.
And one other thing too, Larry, not only do you want to have your car out front to see how it pulls everybody around there, you also want to get back in that pack and be around some of this traffic to make sure that the car is not getting buffeted around, make sure that the cowl is working like it should as far as when it's in that air that's so disturbed. You need to make sure that your car will do everything you want to do from front to back and back to front. It's really important that you work the car in that kind of configuration.
And I would say the timing of that pit stop in that second segment, that 50 laps, that's going to be pretty critical. That's another thing these guys are trying to do. They're trying to see what their fuel mileage is, and with this bigger restrictor plate. And Matt, I think you have the man that's fastest in this practice.
And Dale Earnhardt Jr. is done. First off, he said hello to the Dirty Mo Posse. Who is the other group?
Oh, that's my buddies on the DMP board, just some friends of mine. All the guys on FLM, and just the guys I race on the computer with all the time. And we have a lot of fun, but they're all watching.
Well, what can you tell them about this car? Is it a 10?
Yeah, it don't drive as good as my car on the game does. It's pretty fun, but they took a lot of grip away from the cars with the softer tire. The tire's good for a couple laps, and then it just wears out, and you slide all over the place. But we had a bad rear gear that first practice, and it was locked up, and we fixed that, and now the car's pretty good.
We saw you cut through the field very, very strong.
Yeah, we're pretty strong. Just got to keep the tires on it, wearing the tires out before we run out of fuel. So, don't know what to do about that. Can't lift, you know. Nobody else is lifting. So we'll just have to figure out how we can save the tires on the car. I think running the high line will help, but you can't run up there by yourself. You'll run in the back, you know. So if we can run up off the bottom a little bit, it might keep the right front on the car a little bit. And maybe I can get some guys up there and run up there. But, you know, we go back to we got a little more rear spoiler that we ain't run here in Daytona yet. They put it on at Talladega at the end of the season. So a lot of guys ain't thought about that we got more rear downforce, not as much front. So.
Junior, very confident, looking for back-to-back wins here in the shootout, Mike.
And so he should be. That car worked very, very well in this evening's practice. 19 drivers will square off at the Bud Shootout tomorrow night. You'll see it live on TNT. But you'll get your fill of Daytona beginning at 10 a.m. tomorrow when we have NEXTEL Cup practice.
It's going to be interesting tomorrow night. A lot of veterans in this race a lot versus a lot of those young guns. We see it a lot in every race.
And the big thing is, guys, can Dale Earnhardt Jr. do it again? The other thing is, I'm really curious who's going to be lucky enough to get the luck of the draw tonight to see where the starting positions all kind of come out.
We'll let you know tomorrow. Join us on Speed at 10 a.m. tomorrow for NEXTEL Cup practice. Good evening from Daytona.
On-track activity is almost done for the day. NASCAR NEXTEL Cup competitors getting a few last laps of practice in for tomorrow's Budweiser Shootout. Soon all will be quiet, but we're here with you for the next 30 minutes to put a wrap on the day. Hello again and welcome to Speed Weeks on Speed presented by LaVitra. I'm John Roberts, and along with us once again, veteran race broadcaster Ken Squire. Now, Ken, when this practice session actually does get wound up here in just a moment, a couple things about it. It's the first true practice because they are under the lights, and it is now a chance to see what these new cars, new teams can really do under true race conditions.
And I truly think that we're on our way to seeing our fourth back-to-back win in the 26 years of the Bud Shootout. No question that what we saw this afternoon was just kind of sorting things out. But when it got serious tonight, temperatures the same as it will be tomorrow night at approximately 8 o'clock when they roll these cars out. Then you saw Earnhardt Jr. this evening come to the front of the fray. He's the quickest thing out there, and I think that that's going to stand pretty steady through 70 laps, 175 miles here on Speed Channel tomorrow night.
I think that's a pretty safe prediction right there, Ken. It is time now for our LaVitra Top Performer of the Day, and when it comes to practice, it's the hot laps that get the headlines. Ken was just talking about this guy right here. It is Dale Earnhardt Jr., fastest lap in practice this evening, 191.038 miles per hour. Again, he is the defending champion of this race. And there is a little bit of business that has to be taken care of yet tonight. This race does not set the starting grid by qualifying. They do it by luck of the draw. In just a little while, outside of the racetrack, they will decide who will start where. Let's go now to Bob Dillner, who's been all over the garage all day long, and he's with one guy who's looking for a good starting spot because he has a pretty good car to run with. Bob?
That's absolutely correct, John. Kevin Harvick's got the car that he's run all the restrictor plate races with last year, and he was awful good here at Daytona last year, so your two practices today, well, what do you think about them?
I think the GM Goodwin Chevrolet is not too bad. Really hard to tell, and you know, except for that first run, where you're at with everything until you get all the cars on the racetrack. But got our car handling pretty good, and just worked on a few odds and end things there. And this car was pretty well refined from last year. We ran it all four races, so just have to wait and see.
How much more important was this particular session than the earlier one?
Well, I think it was the most important for the drivers who'd been sitting around for a couple of months just to get the jitterbugs out of the driver's feet and hands. So it was pretty good. I mean, you know, we just wanted to make sure where we were and understand what the new tire was going to do after 20 or 25 laps, and so far so good.
So y'all relaxed now? You're ready to go tomorrow night?
Yeah, I'm ready, relaxed, and ready to go.
How about a prediction?
You can't predict restrictor plate racing.
That's a prediction. Third fastest is Kevin Harvick. Ralph Jean, who do you got?
Well, this is Jimmy Johnson's primary car. This is a car he plans on running in the Daytona 500. It's under the covers right now because they're getting ready for the Bud Shootout. But if you remember back in the preseason Thunder testing, he wrecked this car, and that threw things off when it came to setting up the car that he plans on running in the Budweiser Shootout. That really kind of threw you out of your program a little bit, didn't it?
Yeah, we had to work through some things in the first practice. Because we didn't have a chance to do any drafting practice down here for the 3 days of testing that we had, like you mentioned, we crashed primary cars. So we worked through some things in the first practice and really didn't find any good luck with it. And we really thought it was going to help and went back to the basics, and the car climbed up the speed charts and is driving like it needs to.
Was it a process of like, okay, that doesn't work, let's just go back to basics?
Yeah, you know, you'll find that some things work for qualifying to get speed out of the car, but when you get, you know, 15, 20 cars out there and the air is real turbulent, the air isn't sitting on the car the same way, maybe not flowing through the cowl the same way, over the spoiler the same way, so it's a different dynamic. And stuff that worked for us in qualifying trim, we tried in race practice, just didn't work, took it off, went back to our package from last year, and everything's good.
All right, your fifth quickest here in the session, is that a speed that you're comfortable with?
Yeah, it's really, you know, depending on who was pushing you and how much gap you had from where you were to the car in front of you determines where you're at on that speed chart right now. And if you're leading the pack, you're not going to have a fast time. So kind of the way Jeff saw me to look at it, if you can stay at the front of the pack all day long, you're going to have a slow time, but that means you're going to stay up front during the race. So we stayed up front in the pack, and we're going to be good.
Coming up in a little while, about an hour or so from now, you're actually going to draw for your starting position. Now, do you have any tricks of the trade? Is there any special superstitious way you're going to choose?
No, if it's like last year, DW was doing the ceremonies there, and I asked him to tell me when to hit the button. And I listened to him, I hit the button, and I drew second. So I might try that again, but after I did that, everybody else tried it, and they were drawing to the back of the bus, so I don't know if it's going to work.
All right, now we get into the race tomorrow night. It's going to be very similar weather conditions probably to what we have right now. What will that do to the attitude of the car?
really, I think the tire has changed the balance of the car. I think everybody in the pits for a restrictor plate race, we're changing a lot of springs, working on the handling of the car. And that's not typical for Speedway stuff. Usually you run wide open, run around the track, and you work the draft. Right now, even in a small draft out there with 20 laps on the tires, I have to lift and kind of drive the car as I would on an intermediate track. So, you know, I think you're going to see a very interesting race. There might be some wrecks from people trying to drive through a loose condition or an ill-handling condition in the car. But I think once we all get a feel for it and, you know, kind of learn how to drive them on a 2.5-mile track with a plate and lifting and working the draft that way, I think we're going to put on a great race.
Well, John, it's going to make a longer night for him as he's going to have to do more driving, as he can't just put his foot to the floor tomorrow night and roll around here. But for driver's skill level, for the fans, that makes a lot more fun for us. Jimmy Johnson getting ready to go draw his number.
All right, Ralph and Jimmy, guys, thanks a lot. And Ken, everybody gets a little bit of the jitters when they start a season off, or really start anything off to begin with. How important is it for these guys to get a couple laps under their belt now and get really down to the business of driving?
You're talking about tonight, or you're talking about tomorrow night?
All the whole time. Oh, actually, tonight, course. The first practice session,
yeah, well,
have it under your belt.
First practice session tonight is key because you do have the same conditions, and that'll give you a pretty good indication of just where you can go and what you can do with those drafts. And we saw them split the field about 9 and 9 working with each other out there to see what they could do on the banking with all this new stuff with the soft tires and so forth. And it's interesting to me that 1 year ago at this time we kept talking about McMurray as probably the favorite for Rookie of the Year. Well, he became Rookie of the Year, and here he is in the Chip Ganassi car tonight, fourth quickest out there. I wouldn't be surprised if he and John, again, it's the young group. You've only got LeBlanc in the first five who really, among what you'd call the veterans, doesn't seem like veterans to me, that has got it done. So those kids, they've adapted very well to a softer tire.
Okay, and that young guy that was out in front of the pack tonight was Dale Earnhardt Jr. with the fastest time in the final test session this afternoon and this evening. Still to come on Speed Weeks on Speed, presented by LaVitra. We'll get you up to speed on all the day's news. Plus, we'll talk to one guy who's hoping for an all-star night tomorrow as the crews put the finishing touches on their preps for today and the track cleanup crew gets to work as we get ready to head into another day of racing. We'll be right back.
Speed Weeks on Speed Channel is presented by new LaVitra, new choice. Here now, ask your doctor today. And brought to you in part by NEXTEL Coast to Coast walkie-talkies in under a second. NASCAR and NEXTEL, partners in speed.
Well, things are winding down now at the Daytona International Speedway as practice is over for the NEXTEL Cup cars, but they'll be back tomorrow at 10 a.m. and we will have it live on Speed. Welcome back, everybody, to Speed Weeks on Speed, presented by LaVitra. We're wrapping up a full afternoon and evening of practice for tomorrow night's Budweiser Shootout. Let's take a quick look back at what happened on the track just moments ago in the evening practice session. Now, Kevin Harvick was fastest early. He came back out, dropped off on the speed chart just a little bit as some other guys got a little faster than him, but still, Ken, looking very impressive.
Oh, yeah, but remember, he's running all by his lonesome as far as teamwork is concerned tomorrow.
The fast car in the evening. Yeah, Dale Earnhardt Jr. was the fast car in the evening, but there he gets tangled up. That is Mike Skinner behind the wheel of the 10 car. Gonna see it again here, and boy, this early in practicing, that's a little scary.
Well, that's when you find out just what it all has and how much you've got.
All right, Dale Earnhardt Jr.
Earnhardt has a lot.
Yep, has a lot there. 191.038 miles per hour was Dale Earnhardt Jr. as he tops the speed chart after the second Bud Shootout practice session. Bobby Labonte up there as well, and Kevin Harvick slipped from first to third, but the speeds are still up there as they're out there, Ken, running in the true race condition.
And Elliott Sadler from pretty well back up into 10th among the 19 cars. And the big victim here tonight is Bob Sedd, who was third quickest in the afternoon, and he has dropped dramatically back here this evening.
All right, Dave Blaney is a guy that has to prove a lot, Ken. He has to go out there and run. He doesn't have any promises after this week in Daytona. So he has to prove whatever he can when he's out here right now. And he's doing it. He's in the top 10 in speeds.
Yeah, and he's really hoping that something will work out with the Davises. And they're still searching for some sponsorship to carry that other team. I really want to see Blaney work. I love those guys that came out of the Outlaws when they come in here and do well.
Okay, and in case you think we're a little bit crazy by saying Mike Skinner is behind the wheel of the 10 car, Johnny Benson at the end of the season last year parted ways with that group. He is off doing his own deal with the 09 right now. But Mike Skinner has been associated with that group before as driver of the 01 car, and he was one of the guys who earned a spot in this shootout, and he's driving that car.
Yeah, he gets the opportunity to take it out and run the 175-mile distance tomorrow night, 70 laps. I used to love this race at 25 laps, and I really wondered what they were doing, and they pushed to the 70. But we had such a great race here a year ago, and the expectation is we'll have the same tomorrow night. This is really, you know, that new show that they're going to have on Speed Channel called Car Search?
Yep.
Well, which is a heck of a show. If you've seen it, it's really fascinating. But Car Search tomorrow night is right here for 170 miles.
That's one of the neat things about this is the fact that you can't have a second chance because of winning a pole last year with a different group. All right, let's get now to Bob Dillner, who is down there with a guy we were just talking about, the defending rookie of the year. Is that correct, Bob?
That's right, Jamie McMurray. And he's like Superman. He's already changed out of his driver's uniform into some plain clothes. And, of course, he's got the Havilland on there. But how was the car?
I think it was really good. We changed some stuff from the first practice to second, and pretty happy with the car. We tried some stuff there later on. I noticed that the tires on went back out, and it wasn't near as good. So I'm pretty happy with our car. We've struggled at the super speedways last year, so I'm pretty excited about it.
More relaxed this year at Daytona, not as a rookie, now as a sophomore?
Yeah, most definitely. I mean, I know most of the guys in the garage and at least you know to say hi to, and I'm not nearly as intimidated, I guess, as what it was last year coming in. So I'm glad I get to run the Bud Shootout, because I watched this last year and I thought, man, these guys are getting so much experience and getting their cars ready for the 500. Even though they're different cars, you still learn some stuff. So we learned a lot getting to go out and run with all the guys in the shootout practice, and hopefully we can take what we've learned today and put that in our 500 car and do well on the 125s.
You got to run with a bunch of different guys out there. Who looks strong?
Well, of course, the 8 car looks pretty good. But really, I didn't see anybody that looked dominant over the rest of the pack. It seems like if somebody can get out front, no one can pass them unless they get a lot of help. We never really got all 15 or 18 guys together at one time, and that makes a big difference. But and I made that comment over there. I said, you know, no one looks dominant. So it ought to be a pretty exciting race.
Now, a lot of times, certain guys work better with other guys. How about you? Anybody in particular you work well with?
I don't know. You know, you just go with whoever you want to. And I did learn last year in my rookie year that there is no deal. You know, you just do what's best for you and forget everybody else, you know. So I don't know. I mean, just find somebody tomorrow, maybe in the first 20 laps, or that you get along with and that your car drafts well with and can give you a big push, or you give them a big push and just work together.
All right, real quick, would you pick yourself for the win?
For the shootout?
Yes.
You know, I think that I think we have as good of a shot as anyone. I don't want to jinx myself or whatnot, but I'd be honest with you. If I didn't think we had a good car, I'd say no, but I think we have as good a car as anyone.
You don't have to worry. I mean, you picking yourself is no big deal, but if John Roberts picked you, you'd be in big trouble.
Yeah.
All right, Bob, thanks a lot, and Jamie, thanks a lot. And he wouldn't mind. I don't think he'd mind if anybody picked him, because Jamie McMurray came on like gangbusters last year, and he does have a shot as anybody else to win because he's got Ganassi horsepower on his
head. Exactly right. That big star on the front of that thing, I think you're going to see a lot of that up in front at the beginning of the year, whereas last year was the end of the year when we saw that thing begin to really function.
Well, folks, stick with us. Still to come, more from the garage and the track as we get you revved up for the season-starting All-Star Shootout under the lights tomorrow night at Daytona. And for all the best in motorsports, please tune in to Speed News. That'll come your way Saturday, tomorrow, 7 o'clock, for extended coverage from Daytona and the world of motorsports. Well, the track may be quiet, but the work goes on in the garage. And if you know anything about these mechanics and these guys who work on these cars, you have to kick them out by the end of the night, or they would stay all night working on those cars. Welcome back to Speed Weeks on Speed Channel, presented by LaVitra. Love it or hate it, the new 2610 Chase for the Championship is here. It's a modified playoff system to decide a NEXTEL Cup championship. Let's hear what some of the drivers have to say about it.
I think the chase for the championships is different, no doubt about that. Would I have done what they've done? Personally, no, I wouldn't have done that.
Well, I'm a proponent of it. When I first heard it, I have to admit, I thought it was crazy. But the more I thought about it, the more I thought, you know, that does make a tremendous amount of sense.
I think that there's going to be a lot of excitement at the end of the year. I think it's going to be really exciting to watch for that 10th place transfer spot. Yeah, the 26th race, 25th race, 24th, whenever they're battling for that top 10, I think that'll be exciting. So, whoever's the point leader, second, third in points, if they have a big lead, probably aren't going to like it because they're going to have a bunch of points taken from them and given to the lower guys. But yet another side of that, probably the third through 10th place guys are going to love it because they're going to get a lot of points and have a legitimate shot at that championship.
I think the point system changes the way you approach the game. Just like I've said before, I think the three-point shot changed the way you coached basketball, because now all of a sudden you've got another tool in your arsenal to beat somebody.
We've got two seasons in one, I believe, and you've got to be good enough in the first part to make it to the second part, and that second part's really going to be where the teams have to put it together and make sure there's no mistakes.
I think it's kind of funny that everybody talks about how differently you're going to race. I can't see where anybody's going to race any different than what they have in the past. It's still about racing as hard as you can and accumulating the most points that you can.
I think the first 26 races, you're going to kind of race the same way that you used to, but you got to make sure you're in that top 10.
If you're 11th on back, you have nothing to lose. You're going to see great racing, a lot of strategy probably being played out by the crews. You're going to see a lot of action there. But in the top 10, the guy who does not DNF one of those races at the end will be the champion.
Well, there are a lot of great points being made right there, but Ken, I think the bottom line of this whole thing is when you get to the end of the NASCAR season, other sports are taking over attention on TV and in the main scope of things in sports. You have to do something to put the attention back on your series.
Yeah, when I first heard about this, I said to myself, gee whiz, how can they make the Great American Race a qualifier? But the more I've thought about it, they do have to do something to beef that part of the season up, that concluding 10 races. So let's give it a try.
All right, now, whether you love it or you hate it, all 43 guys on the track are playing by the same rules. Time to take another break, but when we come back, we'll have more from Daytona in just a moment. Stick around, everybody. The guys are still working in the garage. We're still working here for you on Speed Weeks on Speed. Well, with the exception of the fountain in the infield and some jet dryers on the track, things are pretty quiet here at the Daytona International Speedway. Welcome, everyone, back to Speed Weeks on Speed, which is presented by LaVitra. Let us get you now quickly outside of the racetrack to a member of our broadcast team we have not yet seen today. Steve Burns is on his new home away from home. And as always, Steve has attracted a crowd because he's got a pretty popular guy out there with him, a new face to this Budweiser shootout. Hello, everybody. Hello, Steve.
Hey, JR, is this a sweet unit or what? Home for trackside, outside the track, and we're joined by Boris Said. If you don't know the story, it's a great one. Filling in for the injured Jerry Nadeau at Infineon Raceway in Sonoma, wins the pole. The team was fired up. Here you are for your first stock car experience at the Daytona International Speedway. How did practice go tonight, Boris?
I mean, it went better than I expected. I mean, the Army car ran great. I mean, Nelson Bowers put a great deal together for me to run this car with Jay Fry and Ryan Pemberton, Big Mike in the fab shop. I mean, they gave me a great car, and I have Ernie Irving down here as a coach, so, you know, it's helped a lot because I don't know anything about speedway racing or drafting, so, I mean, I'm trying to learn cold with 2 hours of practice.
Ken Squire noted you were third in the first practice, 12th tonight. Did that mean anything? I would assume you're trying to get comfortable in the draft, comfortable in that race car.
Yeah, I mean, you know, my day job, I work for a company called No Fear. So I didn't want to be scared out there, but the biggest thing is I didn't want to suck out there.
So, that would be bad.
You know, I think I was pretty respectable, and I ran with a lot of guys, and, you know, the spotter never said, hey, stay away from the 01 car because he's a weapon. So, you know, I'm just trying to fit in right now and get some experience, and hopefully tomorrow night, you know, I can get a respectable finish for, you know, everyone in the U.S. Army, all our men and women overseas.
Boris, have you talked to any of the other drivers to get some expertise as far as drafting, where to run, where not to run?
I mean, I've wore Dale Earnhardt Jr. out these last 2 weeks. I mean, if you look at his ear, it's about falling off because I've been asking him so many questions, and he's helped me out a lot. But, you know, before I ran today, you know, he was telling me things, and I couldn't relate to it because I didn't have the experience yet. So tonight I'm going to bug him a little bit in his motorhome, and, you know, he's helped me a lot. Ernie Irvin's helped me a lot, you know. Ryan Pemberton's really good on the radio, trying to, you know, teaching me things. So, I mean, so far it's quicker than I expected.
Boris, briefly, what will be a good night for you tomorrow night in the shootout?
Not to suck.
Don't suck. That's a good thing.
I always watch the Twin 125s. You see that one guy that loses the draft, and I don't want to be that guy. I mean, it'd be stupid for me to, think I could win a race. But if I can go out there and run in the draft, get past, pass some people, and get it, and see the checker flag, it'd be like a win for me.
All right, thanks a lot, Boris. Thanks for your patience. Best of luck tomorrow night. Hey, thanks for dropping by to see the home of Trackside. We'll go back now to Ken Squire and John Roberts.
All right, Steve Burns, thanks a lot. Good to see all the fans out there enjoying that new truck. It's quite a spectacle. That's a good sign of things to come for this year on Trackside. We'll be back in just a moment with more Speed Weeks on Speed Channel presented by LaVitra as we wrap up the day at the Daytona International Speedway.
Speed Weeks on Speed Channel is presented by new LaVitra. New choice, here now. Ask your doctor today.
Well, as the work continues in the garage, Jerry, we want to remind you Saturday at 1:30, another cup practice comes your way. And again, it is live on Speed. Welcome back, everybody. We are almost out of time, so let's get quickly back out to Steve Burns for his Budweiser Shootout prediction. Steve?
Well, John, first of all, I predict that the fans are going to have a great time here at the Budweiser Shootout. I was listening to what Jimmy Johnson said, working with Springs. I think they're onto something. I'll go with that 48. Ralph?
The way the Bud guys here at Dale Earnhardt Incorporated have been running on these super speedways last couple of years, you'd be crazy not to pick them until somebody else steps out and says, we're the guy. So right now, they're the man. That's who I'm taking, Dale Earnhardt Jr. Bob Dillner?
Ralph, I think this is one of the situations where you could be either a hero or a zero. I like the underdog. They'll remember me. If I pick Boris Said to win and he wins, he crosses this finish line first, hopefully you'll remember that I picked Boris Said.
All right, Bob, we'll remember you anyway. Ken, what do you think?
Well, four in a row at Talladega and hotter than the noonday sun at Daytona. On car search here, it's for car number 8, Earnhardt will live.
All right, that is a very wise pick right there, and I know Kevin Harvick doesn't like when I do this. He's told me never to do it again, but I think he's going to win that race tomorrow. I like his chances, and I like his chances for this year. Folks, thanks for joining us on this day one of Speed Weeks on Speed, presented by LaVitra. Tomorrow, things start at 10 a.m. with NASCAR NEXTEL Cup practice. Then we'll be back in the studio at 12:30. For Ken, Bob, Ralph, and Steve, and the entire Speed team, I'm John Roberts saying thanks for coming along for the ride. See you tomorrow.